Hey everybody, welcome back to another episode of The Houseless Podcast. Yes, it's my weekly podcast, The Houseless. I just marked your name off. My name is Peter Agoston, the host and producer of the show. Thank you very much. I record these mostly all in Brooklyn, New York, but you know what? Next week, I'm going to be in Budapest, Hungary for 2 weeks, so I'm hoping to broadcast a couple of episodes from there. So wish me luck. I have some great ideas on deck, and I will be reporting back next week from Budapest. Each and every episode of The House List is edited and engineered by my man CJ Stewart, and this is no different. We have a really great episode, number 36 today, with none other than DJ Jonathan Toubin. And this very special episode of The House List is brought to you by House of Marley. Yes, The House List and House of Marley and the all-new Stirred Up turntable by House of Marley. I've seen this turntable. It's beautiful. It sounds amazing. And we are giving one away on this episode of The House List Podcast. Yes, through June 1st, The House List and House of Marley have joined forces to give away one of House of Marley's brand new Stirred Up turntables to a lucky listener. Listen, I've been collecting records for over 25 years. That's no joke. Me, Peter Agoston, aka Thanksgiving Brown. So turntables, headphones, speakers, all that's essential to me. And a lot of these episodes I've recorded and edited with House of Marley headphones. So when we had the opportunity to give away one of these brand new turntables to one lucky listener here of the Houseless Podcast, I jumped at the opportunity. It's a super, super cool piece of machinery. You can, one, look at houseofmarley.com/turntable, and there's a lot more, some great videos there. But it's made of solid bamboo plinth, recyclable aluminum alloy platter. It's sustainably crafted, and it comes with an Audio-Technica cartridge. It's a built-in preamp, USB, and a headphone jack. And if you are anything like my guest on today's podcast, DJ Jonathan Toubin, then you collect 45s, so you play 45s. Well, this plays 45s and LPs, so 33 and 45. Yes, check it out, y'all. I'm giving away this Stirred Up turntable. You have until June 1st to write me at TheHouseListPodcast@gmail.com. And in the title, write Stir It Up. And at one listener at random, whoever writes me, will be picked at random. And then House of Marley will ship you a brand new Stir It Up turntable. Yes. So again, the Stir It Up turntable. Create a classic sound that reveals the true depth of your favorite music. This streamlined design features natural bamboo, a built-in preamp that's compatible with any of your speakers, especially any House of Marley product speaker that you might have. And I'm telling you, I use these products and they're amazing. They sound great. I got a laptop that doesn't have a speaker, so I plug in the auxiliary speaker all the time when I'm watching movies with my lady, and they're amazing. And this turntable is absolutely no exception. It's really dope. It's really sleek and cool. So either check them out on Instagram at House of Marley, or go to thehouseofmarley.com/turntable to see some videos and some pictures actually of the Stirred Up turntable, which we're giving away on this episode, episode number 36. Write me at thehouselesspodcast@gmail.com. When you're done tuning in to this epic conversation with me and Jonathan Toubin, and in the title line, stir it up, and give me your name, and then we'll pick it at random, and then one lucky winner by next month is going to get this House of Marley Stir It Up turntable. All right, y'all. So let me tell you a little bit more about my guest, DJ Jonathan Toubin. So originally he's from Texas. He's lived in New York for a long time. Many know him from New York Night Train. Many know him from the Skull Clap DJ parties. But he's had like, you know, 10, 20 at least different residencies all throughout New York City. You can catch him in August at the Pickathon Festival in Happy Valley, Oregon. And I know that's going to be great. I've been there before, and I know Jonathan is perfect for that too. He's in New York weekly. You can find him. And we talk a lot about regional soul labels. We talk about Texas, music in Texas, punk, psych, hardcore scene, and just the New York scene and how it's evolved since he got here, how he sort of fell into his career. And it was incredible and a very personal conversation because, as some of you know, Jonathan went through a very traumatic accident where he was struck by a car while sleeping in a hotel room on tour in Portland, Oregon, some years ago. And for some strange reason, I got the first call from the EMT when they arrived on the scene. I don't know why or how. And we chat about it a little bit at the end of the episode. So it's something, we have a lot of strange things in common. And I think it was really great that we finally were able to have a conversation, talk about music and life and records. And this is definitely one for the books and definitely one for music fans and collectors out there. So without any further ado, let's get into my conversation with Jonathan Toubin, and I'll catch you guys on the outro. Yeah, so now when it comes to like the stuff you do, because now you've been doing these parties that are based around 45s that come out both on these like really famous labels as well as obviously small regional independent stuff. And, you know, the 50s and the 60s, the 7-inch, the 45 was like the medium. I mean, this is like jukebox culture is at a high in America and possibly abroad. So I'm just trying to get a sense too, because
perhaps the height of our popular music, recorded music,
sure,
as well.
That's interesting. Yeah, that could, that's arguable for sure.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously because there's so many, there's hundreds of labels that are producing that stuff, right?
Well, I think there were some interesting things. First of all, I mean, I do think the aesthetics of the time were overall pretty great. I think a lot of people post-war design for architecture, for automobiles, for lots of things, because right. there was a certain elegance and modernity mixed with stuff that we now, you know, still attached enough to the old world.
Yeah.
So where, you know, I guess it had meaning.
Yeah, and it was durable, well-made. Yeah. I mean, furniture of that era, clothing. Yeah, automobiles and architecture, too. But you look at those record labels, you look at the layout, mostly all laid out by hand, too.
No, it's great. And the thing is that, you know, a lot of interesting development happened. You know, for instance, in World War II, they were listening and wondering how, you know, these German orchestras were playing in the middle of the night. And later on, when they came in to Berlin, they were like, oh, magnetic tape. Like, they didn't have that. And Bing Crosby got one of the machines.
Really?
Yeah, and gave it to Les Paul. I was like, figure this out or whatever. You know, so really, you know, right after that, a lot of things started going on. Like, records started sounding a little better. And, but it wasn't yet the point. I mean, you know, Les Paul was already multi-tracking, or, at the beginning of the, you know, 1949, you had the 45 and the 33
right.
come out, which also sort of, in a way, democratized things because basically when you say an album used to be literally a book of 78s.
Right, right.
And so the two ways of looking at it, like one of the companies had the 45, which you put on a spindle and they go all like that, and then you flip it over to your side too. And then one of the companies had a 33 where instead of it being stacked up, it was, it's as we know it now, it's spread out.
Right. And Did you ever get into 78s? Collecting 78s?
Oh, I love them. I just don't mess with them much because they don't travel well. They're very breakable and they sound amazing. Like, honestly, if you want to hear, for instance, Howlin' Wolf, like, if you haven't heard Moaning at Midnight on 78, you haven't heard it yet, man. Mm-hmm. It's amazing. Some of the things, it's just, you know, sort of how the 45, I feel, is the best format for a lot of the, you know, definitely for the 60s music and a lot of the later 50s music. I feel for, you know, early to late 50s, like rock and roll and blues kind of stuff. You know, if you like a good 78 from 1955 is about the height of technology for what it is, and super explosive. But anyway, what I was going to say is that the one thing that was unusual about it was that there was a monopoly in the music industry before World War II, pretty much. And there's a lot of, there's a million things you can talk about. One of them would be, I guess, ASCAP went on strike in the 40s because they weren't paying them for radio music. So BMI was a thing, and that basically included a lot of hillbilly artists, a lot of black artists, stuff like that, that ASCAP was kind of snobby and didn't want to touch. ASCAP was started by Irving Berlin and all the songwriting establishment in the 1910s. So when those guys went on strike, the radio station's like, well, we'll just get music from somewhere else. Yeah. And then at the end of the war, you know, basically ASCAP and the major label monopoly and all that, they went back to doing exactly what they were doing before the war. So basically it allowed all the people that they overlooked, which are mostly, I guess, poor people.
Sure. And people that are outside in New York City as well, right? Is this like post-Tin Pan Alley?
Even in New York, though, New York always had these sort of shady things, like Tin Pan Alley kind of wound up in the Brill Building, and they had their own things. But all over New York and New Jersey, you had all these little tiny industries. And one of the things I think that you can't ignore is that basically during World War II, you know, there was this great migration. I mean, the original great migration before that, but World War II, all these people started coming in to work in factories, whether it be in Chicago and Detroit or Houston and Los Angeles or even somewhere like, I don't know, Beaumont, Texas or, you know, Pensacola. Beaumont. Like all over, people were coming to work at these places. And a lot of them were the kind of people that were not allowed in the workplace because of different things, like women, minorities. So they were all working. They all had disposable income. The war made it where we didn't really have a war on our soil, so it depressed everybody else. It greatly benefited us. Mm-hmm. So our factories were pumping, and even after the war, I mean, we were selling the rest of the world all of our goods, you know. So these people were all working and had disposable income, and a lot of them were new to the city. So someone like, I guess a great example would be Muddy Waters. He came from Mississippi, came to Chicago. Chicago, they were putting out all this other music. But immediately when they put out a Muddy Waters record, everyone bought it because there was this diaspora from Mississippi living there. And they wanted to hear the music of Mississippi. But obviously, Muddy Waters is now in Chicago, and so were they. So it wasn't exactly like, it was Mississippi blues, but it was electrified. It was different.
Yeah.
And so basically, like, the Chess Brothers found a whole new market with that. And they realized, you know, if we can sell all these, we can keep these pumping out. And they were able to make a profit if they sold, even 10 years down the line, 60,000 Howlin' Wolf records, that was a profit. Whereas in the bigger music industry, that wouldn't be considered much of a success.
Right, right.
So they basically build these artists and sell small quantities over time. And the 45 was sort of like the demo tape was in the 80s. Like everyone, like you could take a chance putting one out by a smaller artist if you're a regional label. But if you're a local label or you're a guy that decides to become a local label, you could technically just, for very little money, put it out, and you could really just hand it to a DJ. And because radio programming in the 50s was still localized, you could just hand it to the guy. Top 40 started coming in the late 50s, which changed a lot of the way that people dealt with things. And then over time, you know, the DJs became less important, and it became pre-programmed, particularly by, like, you know, I'd say by 1970 or so, you had, you know, way fewer indie labels, you had way fewer radio stations where DJs were picking their own tracks. You did have less payola or whatever, and the payola scandal at the end of the 50s was a way to basically, for ASCAP and the bigger labels, you know, to give the finger to all these little guys that were doing stuff. Because honestly, while those guys were sleeping and putting out Sing Along with Mitch and, you know, trying to revive Andrew's Sisters or doing whatever major labels were doing back then, the little guys were making a lot of money. And like, you look at 1955, you had Chuck Berry and Bo Diddley on Chess having, you know, really, really big hits. You had Elvis, you know, that's the year that he really started blowing up his son. You had Little Richard. So all of a sudden, all these people, you know, this rock and roll was coming, and the major labels totally slept on it. The entire industry slept on it. And during that point, what they hadn't realized is, much like what I grew up with in the 80s and 90s, all these independent forms of distribution were set up. So you already had all these distributors, you had these mom and pop stores, you had the radio stations, you had this whole, you know, system for these little subcultures. And also black radio was just starting out. Country radio, as we know it, was starting out. Like a lot of these things that people weren't doing were becoming a standard in every city. And what was happening that was also changing the world was these white kids were sitting at home and they were able to eavesdrop on black culture through radio.
Yeah, and so, absorb all of that.
Yeah, so all these Elvises were sitting around listening to this music. And go, whoa! And so it created a really democratic marketplace. And it really, I think, you know, by the 1956 or so, when they bought Elvis's contract, when they were getting Pat Boone to do Little Richard covers, when the major labels were, they were doing everything they could to destroy these networks, but they were so strong already. And like the Chitlin circuit and the, and these reviews and theaters, everything was already really tight. So it took them many, many years. The Paola scandal helped them out a lot, but it took them years to wipe all this away. So basically, when you're buying a record from a little label in 1963, even, it's still a label that has a chance, even if it's from some small town, right, has a chance in its town. Which, by the way, if you put out a little record in your town, a band that plays at dances and it plays on the radio, you would make a profit just from that.
Sure.
And then if that became a regional hit and they started playing it in the region, national hit, all that was possible. So it really inspired people to create more and to be independent business people.
Right.
And it inspired a lot of artists. It empowered a lot of artists to just get out there and do it.
What do you think would be like a really a great example of a small town or small city record that then broke out on like a regional level that then became like a national or international hit? It started as an indie. I mean, there's obviously a lot
of... I was just thinking one the other day. I got the Wayne Cochran original version of Last Kiss.
Okay.
You know, that murder song?
Yeah.
And but there's a Texas one, and I can't remember what... The band is like somebody and Frank, somebody in the Cavaliers. We don't even remember the name of this guy, even though people still listen to his version when they're not hearing Pearl Jam's version or whatever, you know.
Uh-huh.
And, man, you know, it was some little local Texas small town label, and it broke out. And it went, it's a great story I was thinking about because, I mean, Wayne Cochran wasn't a known guy either, and he had this small, you know, I think it was from Georgia or Northern Florida. I think it was Georgia record that no one bought.
Right.
Some guy in Texas found it. They covered it in the small town, and it became a regional hit. It became a national hit. But honestly, almost everything that wasn't, you know, from a larger label back then was the product of, you know, something like the Tighten Up. I was talking to Archie Bell the other day about it's so weird. Like he was just this guy that sang this track with this band, the TSU Tornadoes, who was a Houston local band on a very small Houston label, and he sang the song. The song picked up in Houston. Atlantic picked it up the next year for a national release because it did so well in Houston, and it's still, people still play the Tighten Up every day all over the world, you know?
Yeah.
I feel in a lot of ways I was thinking that the music industry was almost becoming that now when things became digital for the first time, because I was actually inspired in the aughts, because I really believed that the record industry was dying, and it gave people an opportunity to create and distribute on a more even level.
Right, that's true.
And what you did see, like I guess today's version of it would be a viral YouTube video.
Yeah. Yeah, YouTube would be an interesting example of that, like what came out of the death of like the CD, and then like we have YouTube, SoundCloud, Bandcamp too, or...
Yeah.
All their own different
kinds. But, you know, definitely, I always think that so many of these things have become really big hits. Like, what was that Psy song from South Korea?
Gangnam Style?
Yeah, Gangnam Style. Like, you know, that video was such a great video, and everyone just shared it because it was so funny watching them do this dance. But the song and the video are kind of the same thing now, and it really, I mean...
Right.
I remember the president referencing Gangnam Style. For things to become... Could you see something like that happening in, I don't know, the 80s, where Reagan, like something, or, you know, Bush Sr., or even, you know, W, like, see something reaching them from some underground sort of form?
No, they would seem impervious to that at that point.
Well, not only that, the system was set up against them. I think it's... To me, I mean, part of why I got interested in this is when I grew up, for instance, punk music, they decided in the United States wasn't worth selling.
Right.
So, you know,
Well, what year are you talking about?
Well, I'm 70, basically late after 70s? 78. Okay. What happened is in the UK, they continued to have major label punk, and someone like Sam 69 or UK Subs or whatever would have actual hits on the English radio.
Yeah.
But in America, you know, they pretty much tried, you know, with the Ramones, they tried a little bit with the Sex Pistols, these things, even the Clash at that point, and they just really weren't, you know, nobody was really doing that well, and so they just gave up on it. So basically you had, I mean, it always goes back to Black Flag, I guess. But you know what I mean?
Sure.
You had them setting up this touring circuit, and along with it, this record distribution circuit, you know, and then with it, so funny to think that Minor Threat, you know, and for them, Teen Idols, I mean, that's Discord Records. You know, the guys put out their own things. The Dead Kennedys were Alternative Tentacles, you know? Touch and Go is Corey from the Necros and Tesco V from the Meat Man when it started. Like, all these labels were, that I grew up listening to, were all things that these bands that had no voice, you know, New Alliance was the Minutemen, even though stepped up to SST or whatever, you know, like they're, everyone had their own label, and having that label allowed them to enter this form of distribution, which, again, these stores, these record labels, the college radio, the zines, all these things that I grew up with created a world that was so big that by the time Nirvana happened, which you could equate with, like, maybe that year with Elvis in 56 or something.
Sure.
You know, where suddenly the big labels realize they've been asleep the whole time and there's money and all this stuff and there's this mad grab for all these things. And it took them a while to kill culture. They didn't kill it immediately, but they did.
Well, it takes them a while to wake up and then it takes them a while to kill it. And then by the time either one of those things happen, something else now is coming up, I think. You know.
Well, also monopoly capitalism is the one thing that really gets in the way of the real good capitalism, because the real capitalism is what we see in these local markets now. Like, it is great that we're drinking this Brooklyn beer right now, and that, we, you know, in the past, you couldn't go into the local deli and get anything local, like when I grew up.
Sure.
You know, so there's a lot of good things about it, but I do feel that, you know, one thing that's great about those little systems of distribution that I was talking about is that the records that you hear are, particularly in that era, very regionalized, just like they were in the 80s. Like, if you read your Maximum Rock and Roll Scene reports growing up, you know, you would have it mapped out for you either way. But you know that the bands in Texas, for instance, you know, we all had a different sound than living in the Lower East Side or whatever. And today, a band from Texas and a band from Brooklyn, you probably couldn't tell the difference.
Yeah, that's a very interesting point.
And the same thing started happening with the sort of soul music and all that stuff. There were these regional sounds that were happening, and over time, they just became this sort of more national sound. Yeah, or international
sound. So what were your bands in Texas then, growing, like in, say, high school? Because you were it was straight punk rock, or was it?
No.
More like a hardcore, like, punk rock?
Well, when I started going to see bands, all there was pretty much was hardcore, if you didn't accept. Like, I ran into a guy the other day, by the way, this guy's so cool. His name's David Dove, and he has something called a Nameless Sound in Houston.
Okay.
And they fly in all experimental musicians from all over. And they teach kids, and they do a show in Houston where they normally wouldn't do it. So anything from New York Loft musicians to Pauline Oliveris was always there. And she died, like, she was a big proponent. But, like, so this guy, I met him in line at a Butthole Surfers concert in 1987.
Okay.
And definitely, even by that point, I mean, I was 15 or so, but, you know, like, kids like me were looking for a way to get past hardcore, because hardcore had become, you know, like, they had bands called anything with three initials or whatever, because seriously, people, it was such a formulaic kind of thing that seemed kind of dumb by that point for people like us and someone like Butthole Surfers or whatever, Sonic Youth or one of those kind of, I don't know, Pussy Galore, one of these bands from the later 80s that seemed like they were doing something different. And to be honest, it seemed noisier and weirder, because a lot of the hardcore was starting to sound like, I don't know, not that different than what, I don't know, metal or whatever. You know what I mean?
Sure, I absolutely know what you mean. Yeah, I mean, when you start recognizing there's a formula, then, like, it gets kind of boring.
But the late 80s kind of got left out in history, too, because it was one of those periods that, you know, people didn't record well. A lot of that stuff sounds cheesy.
Right.
it didn't really, a lot of the greatness of the people that were of the hardcore scene and then rebelling against it didn't come out well. So most of my bands were contrarian punk bands, you know, like we're in Texas, honestly, everyone, the one regional thing I think that we definitely had is that our biggest regional band was the Butthole Surfers.
Yeah.
So, you know, the way that, I don't know, like Agnostic Front or someone would be here, or maybe like, I don't know, I guess Minor Threat was already done by then, but maybe like, I don't know, Fugazi up in DC or something. You know, we had the Butthole Surfers.
Yeah.
You know, and so,
nice.
You know, we had Scratch Acid. We had, there was a lot of hardcore bands in Texas that were great too. Like, for instance, you know, I definitely saw DRI a couple times around that point too, or whatever, but. And they were also a very weird band in their own way for, you know, if you think about it, like Violent Pacification or, you know, the Dirty Rotten EP with the little 40-second songs. Like, they weren't a generic band.
Right.
But Texas always, I think the one thing is Texas has a, you know, throughout history, like a rugged individualism and a contrarianism.
Yeah.
And well, people, I mean, there like to test the water.
Well, like, I mean, Rocky Erickson would be probably a good example of that too, although that's... from one generation maybe removed, right? Would you say?
Well, in a sense, maybe more Tommy Hall. I mean, Rocky Erickson, I think, in a way, was just this great blend of all the rock and roll things that happened all to that point.
Yeah.
Listen to his first band, The Spades. You know, they had a, you know, that original version of You're Gonna Miss Me and the...
yes.
And what was the other one? The was it Tried to Hide? I can't remember. But that single, you know, he already has this little Richard voice that's amazing. And he already, you can hear that... You know, they just picked up all the best things from the British Invasion and the rock and roll before, the frat rock before it. And then I think Tommy Hall is the guy that brought the psychedelic drugs, the weird ideas, that jug. And then, you know...
Did you see them play?
Like, the Elevators?
Yeah.
No. I've seen Rocky many times. Yeah. But I think the only gig they did, the proper Elevator gig, was at Psych Fest last year.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, but my whole youth, they, you know, obviously Rocky wasn't even playing. They tried
that was his, like, time,
he
dark
was
period.
On the wrong medicine. And,
right.
But we all just stopped. I mean, my stepdad gave me the first two Elevators albums. That's how I found out who they were.
Like, nice.
I was listening to Jimi Hendrix and The Doors and all stuff in middle school, and he's like, you should hear this. It's better.
Wow.
He was right.
Yeah.
Way better. But
that's awesome.
But the thing about it is, yeah, there definitely is a contrarian... individualist spirit to the Elevators, that when you hear the Elevators, you're clearly not hearing some other Nuggets band or some other generic garage band. The Elevators are clearly the Elevators, and the Elevators definitely were an inspiration for generations of counterculture music in Texas. Even by the time I was around, old guys still told you about them. I remember playing a gig once and the Shiva's headband guys came and liked it, or what, he went, whoa, who's that? Or, like, you know, you always hear about Bubble Puppy dudes and...
I don't know anything
about
that.
Or by, you know, Red Crayola, like the... The mother of... the mother of Mayo, Hazel, taught with my mom.
Really?
So I grew up kind of knowing about who they were. In a public school, yeah. And so...
What town were you from in Texas?
Houston.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. And then I moved to Austin in my teens, and so yeah, it that legacy was always there of weirdness. And then you think of things like, of course, like the Elevators when they went to San Francisco in '66,
right.
Like, and you hear how bad like the Dead and Jefferson Airplane and Great Sight, all those bands were back then. And no offense to anyone that likes that stuff, but those bands were no 13th floor Elevators. You know, Big Brother Holding Company, who, by the way, Janice also. Texan. And then, you know, after the Elevators visited, you know, they definitely helped give, you know, they didn't get to go back to San Francisco because of legal problems for the Summer of Love. They were already gone by the time all those people were using their ideas.
Yeah, but their influence was kind of remained, you're saying, right?
Yeah. Apparently everybody, you know. I mean, these people were playing basically, I mean, so hard to imagine all these people coming out of, like, the folk scene.
Right.
Like, you'd always think they would have come out of like more of a garage or frat rock or rhythm and blues, like they were in some band like the Sonics. But these guys all came out of folk.
Yeah, playing acoustic guitars
on the West Coast. Yeah, so it's sort of like, you know what I mean? They had a lot of rocking to do.
Yeah. What about, this is kind of jumping to a totally different kind of artist, but still in Texas. And I forgot if he's from Austin or not. But did you see Daniel Johnston back then?
Oh, well, I saw Daniel when he came back. When I was younger, Daniel didn't really play out very much. He was a he was just making all those tapes. And I worked at the record store where in the early 90s where he, you know, he ended up painting a mural on the side of our store. And
what was his shop?
It was called the Sound Exchange, and it was formerly called Record Exchange. And there's one in Houston that's still there.
A Record Exchange?
Yeah, well, it's called Sound Exchange, it was called Record Exchange when I grew up. And I would take the bus, a little kid, and the guy, the singer for Really Red, used to work there. Ronnie Bond, Yuan Bondage.
Okay, and, I'm not hip to that band.
Really Red was one of the great, unusual hardcore bands. And they're really well known to a lot of people elsewhere because they have... they have a song on Let Them Eat Jelly Beans. It's one of the standout tracks. And their song, I Was a Teenage Fuck-Up, which is on this great little EP, became a sort of canonical in the Killed by Death kind of era song that more younger people know it than people my age, oddly.
Interesting, yeah.
And they even, it's so funny, I bought an album by them and that was, it's called Rest in Pain. And it was one of the, it was their last album. And I bought it at that record store at the recommendation, of course, of I was, you know, at the counter going, what should I get? And that guy was there and everyone, oh, you should get Really Red. Or, you know, so I bought his band.
That's hilarious.
But they covered War Sucks by Red Crayola.
Oh, cool.
So, I mean, that whole thing always keeps coming back. You buy the Spaceman 3, you know, and they had a record when I was in high school that had, it's called Perfect Prescription. It had a Transparent Radiation by Red Crayola on it, you know what I mean? And they also covered an Elevator song and on the first one. They did reverberation.
So connecting some stuff.
Like so every time that you went through all these things that that you would like, it was cool being in Texas because things kept pointing. You know, I had a Dwarves 45 that had a like 1 minute version of Hurricane Fighter playing in the late 80s or early 90s somewhere. Like, you know, like maybe like around the time I was like 18 or whatever.
Right.
And you're like, oh, wow, they're into this, too. And it sort of was interesting because in that time before the internet, you didn't really know how people found things or what people like. You read an interview with a band and they would say, oh, you know, we really like the 13th Floor Elevators. And it would get you into that.
Absolutely.
But but what was really great was that all these things, you know, you started seeing these cues from the stuff you listened to that the subculture was very large and interesting, too. These weren't boring.
No,
people making
not at all.
The stuff, you know.
Well, Daniel Johnson too. I mean, so he would come into the shop and just sell tapes.
His manager Jeff Tartikoff always kept us with tapes, but Daniel would always try to come in when he got out of the hospital and sell drawings.
Oh wow!
And I always thought it was exploitative, and I would never buy them. But some of my friends did, and those drawings are worth a lot of money now.
I don't doubt that. Yeah.
But he came back years later, and he was all right. But Daniel Johnson wasn't the kind of guy that. I think it's ever very well remembered as that. I don't think he played many live act dates in his day.
Right.
He was more of a... those cassettes were ubiquitous.
Right.
Even in Houston when I was a kid. Like, they were
part
of who we all were.
Sure. You had some in the... You listened to some?
Oh, of course, man. They were also very cheap.
Right, yeah. What about... this is totally jumping into a totally different space as far as Texas artists go, but... another one that was kind of like Daniel Johnson was Jandek.
I didn't get into Jandek until I was 18 and in college, and I found out about him working at the college radio, and all the kids that worked at the college radio, this back when college radio was pretty deep, it wasn't like some people playing like indie rock or whatever. Indie rock back then was considered underground music.
Right.
And yeah, I mean, that would be called also, like, alternative rock, what people now call indie rock or college rock.
College rock.
But really even college rock, the kids in college didn't much. I mean, some of them did, but, you know, a lot of those kids were deep. They liked Jandek. And Jandek, though he was from Houston, he might as well have been from Mars. No one had ever seen him before.
Right.
No, everyone knew that Corwood Industries had a Houston address, but no one even knew he was from Houston. For all they know, he could have been from Poland, and that could have been the address of the P.O. box. It was just...
Sure.
I remember once Bob Guccione Jr. came in for South by Southwest, and I was like 19, and he told me and my friend at the station that if we found Jandek, he'd give us money to write an article, because it was this great mystery.
Yeah.
You know, but...
That's interesting, too. It's like the Texas has created a lot of, you know, mysterious artists, too, in that rock canon. I mean, or at least they've been canonized that way, like... Daniel Johnson and Rocky Erickson and Jandek, you know, where they have these they're pretty eccentric people that have stories.
Well, a lot of the things I think with Daniel Johnston and Rocky Erickson is the mental problems.
Yeah.
And honestly, you know, the state in Austin, particularly the state institutions, like everybody works at the school for the blind. Mm. A lot of people work in mental hospitals. So like, it's very much a weird part of life when they're like, you know how they drop off, you know, people with mental problems when they get out of the hospital in San Francisco notoriously. They do that in Austin too, or they used to.
Drop them off, what, just like at the bus station?
Yeah, they just drop them off in Austin, and that's where the state mental hospital is anyway, so.
Is it that building that's right downtown, like
on the state mental hospital, last time I visited, which I had a roommate that went there, and I knew a lot of people used to go there, but you know, and the thing is in Texas, people do a lot of psychedelic drugs. I don't know why, but there was something, I think part of that elevator's legacy and butthole surfers and all that. There was a very trippy culture, and a lot of people that couldn't handle it ended up in those places.
Right. The one time I probably ate the most amount of mushrooms in my life was in Texas, in Denton. I was on tour with some guys. I was DJing, some hip hop dudes, AWOL One, Z Man, and this guy Brycon. And we had a day off in Denton, Texas. We played Rubber Gloves the night before. This was like 2003.
Great place.
And yes, awesome time. And we had a day off, and we spent the whole day, we like crashed at my friend's girlfriend's house. She like lived above a garage. It was like classic scenario. So we just ate a big bag of mushrooms and like watched like 8 movies, like back to back to back, like for a whole day, just completely enthralled, laughing, and just didn't even leave the house. We're just like eating mushrooms all day long. Like, that was my
Welcome to Texas.
Yeah. It was perfectly fun. It was great, actually. Yeah.
Now, that was an interesting thing. There was definitely a counterculture in Texas, I think, might be a little more interesting in a Denton or Austin, because most of the people in those two towns don't come from those towns.
They're college
And there's people
towns.
That are misfits in these giant cities that are kind of not just square, but they're kind of oppressive towns. I mean, I love Houston. I every time I go there, I like it better than Austin these days. But
oh, cool.
I mean, there's so much going on. You forget how much there is, particularly in terms of things that aren't music.
Yeah.
You know, they always had a great art scene there. They always had, you know, definitely for music that's not rock and roll, like hip hop. And, you know, they've been chopped and screwed there, you know?
Absolutely, yeah. DJ like, Screw a lot. Like
the,
I mean,
the Ghetto Boys are from there. Right?
Yeah, partially Rap-A-Lot Records.
Gangsta Rap. So Houston always had a lot of interesting things.
I mean,
like
Mike
that.
Dean, too, who's like a gigantic producer.
Oh, yeah, you know? Still around.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, Houston always had, you know, I guess, you know, they always had culture, but it was always a really oppressive town. Even in the 50s, or even if you listen to, like, Midnight Special by Lead Belly, he's already going, if you're ever in Houston, you better walk right, you better not gamble, you better not fight, they can throw you in jail, you know? Like, you know, Andre Williams wrote a book a few years ago, and it's so funny, because he lived in Houston for a while, and he put it as the most oppressive place in there, too. Like, it was just...
Wow.
You know, these towns in Texas, like the law and all that, there, and that's where the elevators are always getting in trouble. Like Houston and Dallas, and mostly those are the two big ones. But, you know, it's just all this trouble. So people move to Denton or Austin where they can just have fun and relax a little more. And
have you done gigs, like, in further south Texas, like when you DJ, like McAllen or
I wish.
Laredo?
Have you ever done? I'm sadly stuck in, like, the...
In the city, the major cities.
Yeah, like I love playing in small markets. I tend to do pretty well, but they tend to just have me in wherever there's some hipsterville or whatever. You know, they got mini Williamsburg in some city.
Right.
That's where I tend to be. So, but I would love nothing more. I've been getting so into this regional music from there, and I've even found a lot of great McAllen records.
No way, really?
Some great labels, yeah. And, you know... So much great San Antonio stuff.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
It's just, it's really, I would love to be more about the map. And I think that the map, honestly, is expanding again.
Yeah.
But I think the internet mixed with the really sort of tough job markets for millennials and all that means that a lot of people are staying in these smaller, more affordable places, whether they're with their parents or getting cheap housing and making cool things. And I think these cities like New York, man, it's a lot harder to find cool people compared to some of these other places I visit,
because
you know,
I know. Yeah, we were just talking about that too before we started, just how that New York scene is kind of refracted or kind of is a little displaced now too. I mean, you've been DJing in New York now. Well, what year did you move to New York?
I moved here in 98, but I wasn't a DJ. I was just a musician back then.
Yeah, so you had two. You had a couple bands where you play guitar in bands, right?
Well, it's funny. Back then, I got paid not for guitar. I'd been a guitarist up to that point, and then I was here for a summer at the end of a tour. I was in this band, did like a 90-day tour, and we're moving to Chicago. And we played...
Oh, that was Noodle?
No, that was the Hammocks. Okay. And we played over 80 nights in the 90 days, and we only stayed in one motel. Like, we're very tired.
You just slept in the van or something, or...?
No, mostly we stayed at people's houses. Oh, yes, we've been touring a lot, and we knew people, and everyone knew somebody somewhere in most of the places. Yeah. And, it's a couple nights at a van and a truck stop in a weird town, but overall, right. The kindness of strangers and friends.
So you ended up in New York or something?
Well, we were supposed to go to Chicago, and one of the guys got a DUI, so he had to go to Maryland to live with his sister while he and work to earn money to go, so we didn't have to be in Chicago yet, so I thought... You know, my friend's girlfriend was leaving for the summer in New York, so I thought, I'll just go move into New York. So I moved to New York for the summer of 1998. And yeah. I thought I was, and I kept telling this band in Chicago I was going to, you know, join them. But one of the things, I guess, is I joined all the bands I could when I was here because I didn't plan on staying. So I was like in four bands. And then I got asked to, some of these guys that were in these bands we played with, from the past, had a band that had got signed to Slash Records, which was at that point attached with London. Slash London was a label, and they were, you know, Universal Entertainment, basically.
Yeah, and I mean, well, this is 98. Okay, so yeah.
It was called Polygram. It was before it was called Universal.
Right. So Faith No More was already kind of off the label then, because that's where Faith No More first was on Slash.
Yeah, no, they had, but they did have Roddy's other band, Imperial Teen, and they Asian Dev Foundation. I'm trying to remember who was on Slash.
Who were your label mates at the time?
Oh, I'm sorry?
Those were your label mates.
Right? Yeah, we play at those things with the, you know, at the music conferences, and those were the kind of bands. I can't remember who else. For a minute, Echo and the Bunnymen, we did a tour with them because they were on the label for a minute.
Oh, wow. Yeah. What year was that?
It's like 98 or something.
Oh, cool.
But I think, I don't remember. But the thing that was great was, so... These guys didn't have like a keyboard player, and they needed the label one. It's to sound like the record, and they were on a retainer. So I just sort of, they're like, "Why don't you play keyboards?" I'm like, "Man, I don't know how to play keyboards. I'm a guitarist." And they're like, "You can figure it out." One of the guys is in rehab, so I started getting a salary just to be in this band. So I was like, "Well, I should." And I was in New York, which is kind of my dream. I always wanted to be here. I just didn't think that I was responsible enough to ever be able to, because you know how it is, you live in Texas and you see people come and go from New York all the time and they fail and they come home. I didn't want to be another one of the casualties, you know.
Right.
But I had a little job, so I went and I did, and I spent like a couple years, and I moved over to bass pretty soon after that. But I didn't even get to do what I did with the band I got paid to be in for a couple years because, you know, they never needed a guitarist.
But you did go on tour playing keys?
Yeah, and then playing bass, yeah.
Interesting. Huh.
Yeah.
That's not like, people don't really necessarily, now they, you're so much associated as a DJ and like a selector and like a curator, but the band stuff is like just it's another.
Well, I have a very undistinguished career as a band guy.
Right.
Like, I'd be one of those dudes that would write one of those books years later about being in millions of bands and never having any success, but traveling a lot and meeting all the other people. Right. Like, I was one of those guys that kind of, you know, I don't know. I mean, I just played with all kinds of people, and I kind of slipped through the cracks in it. Honestly, when after September 11, I was like, all right, I'm 30, you know, and all this stuff is going on. It's really bad. I need to get, and I couldn't work. I used, in New York, once, like, our band got dropped, I got temp jobs, and it was so easy to work. And after September 11, there's no work here.
Right.
It was like a really... the time you need to examine who you are and everything, because it was like, you, other than all the tragedy, and I had worked in both towers.
No way.
Yeah, and I was actually on call that day. I worked in the financial sector, so it was mostly like a few those two buildings and the buildings around it. And
Were you down there?
No, but it's so funny. I would wake up and I would go to the couch near the phone, because back then had a phone on a cord. Isn't that right. funny?
Oh, waiting
and,
for
and I would set my alarm and I would go sleep there and wait for the call from the temp agency.
Yeah.
And I got a call from Houston from an old punk rocker, actually, Rad Richard, who's in the black punk rock movie. He gave me a call. He worked at Continental Airlines. He's like, man, don't go into work today. Because he thought I was working at the World Trade Center every day, which I was just working. So he's like, man, a plane hit it. And so I was there with that guy, Shannon, from the Cows.
Oh, wow.
And he had a guest from Minneapolis there. And we're like, man, we need to go look at this. And the guy on the couch is like, World Trade Center's not going where we go out. They're both on fire.
Holy
crazy.
Shit.
And, you know, like I said, I've been in both of those a lot. Some of them for, you know, a couple months, you know, in those offices.
Wow, really?
So I don't really, you know, I don't keep good relationships with people or talk to anyone at work.
Right. You were just a temp just getting through the day, right?
Well, that, and I just, I don't know. I didn't really have much in common with people over there.
Did you ever go to any of Stephen Dima's events at the World Trade Center? Because, you know, he was a promoter.
Right. No, I went to some things down there. They had some cool, I went to, what's the 100 guitar thing was down there.
No way, really? Oh, cool.
And,
yeah.
Can't remember what else, but then they had... They had some pretty cool experimental music things that, when it was done too, at the World Trade Plaza or something, right near there in Battery Park City kind of area.
Yeah,
with some stuff. But overall, the thing is, down there was nothing cool. It was horrible. I mean, you go up. I worked at 100 or above on two of the buildings, and you would go.
Wow, man.
If you wanted to smoke a cigarette, which I did back then, you would have to go take the elevator down to like the 45th floor or something. You'd go to another set of elevators, take it down. Then you'd leave, and once you got out of the building, you'd light the cigarette, and you look at your watch, and you're like, oh, man. And you would put it out after, like, a couple drags, and you get back in the elevator. We had to go through security, the elevator, go up, get again to whatever, 40, whatever floor, go up to the top. But one time I was working at this Japanese bank for a long time there called Daiichi Kengyo. And the guys, and I think they lost a lot of people in the thing, but one of the people, and no one ever talked to me there. I don't even know if, like I said, it was one of those things where I couldn't tell if it was a culture or language barrier. I never talked to anyone either. We just did my work.
Right.
But one of the guys got me and took me down a floor, down a staircase. Like, I was like, where are we going? And then we opened this door to this office suite, and this cloud of smoke comes out, and there's, I don't know, like, this is an office suite with an entry area and two rooms, and it must have had like 100 Japanese executives in it, and they're all smoking cigarettes and speaking Japanese. And he brought me in there, and I smoked.
Wow.
And I thought, oh, that's how we do it, you know? And there are no windows in that place or anything.
Right.
You know? So it was like, it was raw. But that, it was a really, other than that one nice experience, it was mostly an alienating kind of place to be. And when I saw those things go down, I mean, you know, it was just hard to know what was going on and if people were in there. Like, we couldn't really see.
You couldn't see anything.
We were watching from a bridge, and we couldn't really see when it was going on.
Were you in Brooklyn?
Actually, I was on the Pulaski Bridge between Long Island City and Brooklyn. And it's perfect view of the World Trade Center. You know, we're sitting with all the guys with the orange vests. And they said they were both on fire when we got out there. It was a really weird. But yeah, but it became a thing that once I processed it, you know, it affected me a lot. And then I don't know. I just decided, you know, I couldn't get work. I was really depressed about all that stuff. And it was just a weird city to live in. People were still walking around like, have you seen my father? And you got to be like, oh, man, I hate to tell you. If he was last seen in there, you haven't seen him for a month.
Yeah.
I got to tell you. You know, like, it was just a really, you know, there's like machine guns everywhere. That thing was burning forever.
Yeah.
So I decided that I should come up with a non-music plan for life. Because I never really had a plan anyway, so I decided to go to graduate school.
Oh.
I went to, I applied to CUNY Grad Center, who had a bunch of my favorite people whose books I like and stuff taught there. So I could go there cheaply, so I went there and quit playing music. And the funniest thing is, right when I got out of the music scene, that's when all my friends became famous and when Williamsburg really became a thing. When I quit, like, this became the center of the world. It was like, because it was kind of a dead period in there in the later 90s and early 2000s. And then after September 11, like, when that Strokes album broke, and then the TV on radio and Yeah, Yeah, Yeahs, and all those kind of famous things. It also seem to somehow affect even the most underground stuff from like Black Dice and, right. you know, like Gang Gang Dance and like all these people I knew yes. in the neighborhood were doing, were getting well known around the world, whether it be some really hard to listen to, like challenging noise band or a,
sure.
A famous pop band. And I missed like the whole thing in that. In 2005, I was writing my thesis, and I was already done with all my master work, and I had got into the next level of the PhD history program and all that. And oddly, my thesis was about this. I had this thing published about. I got really interested in when hip hop went downtown, and you know, these kind of weird teenagers from the Bronx,
right.
who were kind of. You know, ostracized from the greater community and not right. considered legitimate by like the black music community or anything, met these, you know, odd misfits downtown, and they started a,
yeah,
you know, this unusual relationship. So I was writing about that, but when I did it, I never really liked or cared about DJs. I have to admit, I was a college radio DJ, but like, and I played a couple of nightclub rock gigs, but like at a show where they want you to play songs between
bands. Yeah, yeah. Like, it's a little different.
Yeah, but I would go out at night in the 90s, and it was just irritating. Like, everywhere you went, now I look back at it, I wish that I was more open-minded, but everywhere I went, I just, there'd be a DJ, you know, and there'd be, like, right. some guy doing ambient techno blending. A lot of people playing dub music and rare groove funk back then. There was even, like, you know, there was soul parties like I do now. There was, yeah. There was a lot of these sort of glam and rock and roll and whatever DJs. Like, everybody's playing music. Most of it, I admit, wasn't the kind of music that I like.
Sure. And at like, that time, it was still... Now, we're talking about what? 2005?
No, I'm talking like...
Or before that.
I'm talking about before that. Like in the late 90s.
It's still all vinyl.
Early,
it's still all wax.
It's all vinyl, and but it's still like... you know, for me at the time, I mean, like I said, I was a fan of like... I don't know. It was Velvet Underground or, you know, Pure Ubu or... I don't know. The Dead Boys or something. Right. I don't know. Like, I liked... A lot of stuff, but it was all, you know, and I like black music, but I really like, you know, I don't know, like early James Brown or like, you know, what I didn't
like blues and stuff like that.
I love blues back then. Yeah. And I like the New York Dolls and, you know, what I don't know.
Yeah. I got you.
I liked a lot of the stuff, and I liked some of the new bands and like, you know, like U.S. Maple to always stay over or like, you know, I right. like, but I never really... liked really shiny, bright, like Northern Soul style music, and yeah. I never liked, you know, I liked reggae, but I thought that dub stuff was so boring when you come in these places and the speed, like boom, 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 you know, and like, so I just never, honestly, I was ignorant. I wish now that I look back at it, nightlife was so democratic to be able to go out in the East Village and Lower East Side and hear a completely different genre of music in every place.
Right.
And it'd be totally unique. Now I would love it. But back then, like I said, I was more just from a rock and roll thing, and I didn't really, in a little bit of experimental stuff, but I didn't really get all this stuff. So when I started studying, I don't know, like all this Afrika Bambaataa stuff and Kool Herc and all
so
these
So when
guys.
You were doing the thesis, you were absorbing...
Well, not that, but it got me interested in these disco DJs and these other people and the way that a DJ... Basically, it made it where I wasn't... I mean, I was still embarrassed to be a DJ when I became one. Because basically, I was earning money. I had a little record label. I started playing in bands again in 2005 because I got the itch.
Yeah.
So I started playing again. I started doing all this stuff. And I got asked to do a DJ gig at Motor City. And I thought, well, you know, I was putting on these shows already. I had the label and the playing. Whatever. I'll do that. And... I was becoming this thing where all these music people, like it was a way for, by 2005, it was a way musicians earned money. Is
so the label was New York Night Train Records.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay. So you earn money on the side to DJ. That's how you'd be a musician. And in the late aughts, that was the thing. But it wasn't that way before. DJs were kind of a different kind of person than a rock and roll musician before then.
Yeah, definitely. Well, there's DJs that are professional DJs. That's all they do. And right. there's people in bands that sort of moonlight as a DJ right. that are more like selectors. They're not like,
right.
They're not the DJs that you would see at some of these legendary clubs that you were referencing.
Again, it's the history of the DJ, you know, it goes back. It's hard to know where to draw the line. But a DJ, as I see it, right. is a person that's a mediator between music and people.
Yeah,
so like a radio definitely. DJ, a club DJ, all that, what that is a person that's playing music
right.
and for people, but that's like, you know, anyway, so at Motor City Bar, you know, where I ended up...
This is Lower East Side of Manhattan.
Yeah, right? I ended up having over 300 and something Wednesday nights there. And, you know,
I saw you there a few times, yeah.
Yeah, it was just this thing where people would go and you'd play records, and no one cares when you're a bar DJ. You know, you just play music and people walk, oh my God, I don't believe what this is. Or they're like, oh, this sucks. Or what, but, you know,
right.
you just communicate with people. And I honestly just looked at it as a fun thing and a little money, but nothing you could live on or anything. And then, but what was weird, I started realizing over that, you know, people kept asking me to do other stuff.
Right.
So, you know, I started playing at my other friends' bars. And I've been hanging out a lot, so I had a lot of places. And
so what was the deal with the label? Because obviously people, when you have a record label too, then people start to associate you with that as well.
Well, it was New York Night Train Records, so yeah. Became my first party was a record release party for Kid Congo Powers.
Cool.
And like, Kid called all his friends. We got Julie Cruz singing, and Jim cool. Sklavounos from the Bad Seeds played, and... you know, yeah, I don't know a bunch of people. Gibby Haynes, I got him the DJ.
Yeah.
Ian Spinotis is the DJ. I got Gibby the MC.
So you're like culling some of these people that you've known now for quite a while, right?
Yeah. And then Ian called me after that because he thought I did a good job, and he asked me to put on a DJ gig for him and Calvin Johnson. Because they're on this tour where he had a book that came out, his first book, and he was doing readings and tours. So I put on one in Brooklyn and one in Manhattan, as it was in the old days. We did Tonic in Monkey Town.
Nice.
So two blasts from the past.
Yeah, I'd say Monkey Town now, it's like, yeah, it's funny to think what that neighborhood now is.
Or Tonic was like one of the best, in my opinion, places we ever had.
Yeah, it was a great room.
So anyway, when I gave the guy at Motor City a flyer for that, he's like, why don't you do something here? And I was like, I don't know. I was just doing this one gig. But then I was like, oh, you're a DJ, whatever. So, but I just got other people to do it mostly. And I would just DJ when, like, I remember the first night I had Bob Burt.
Nice, you know, Bob Burt.
And the
Sonic
next
Youth.
Week was Gibby Haynes. And the next was, I think, I don't remember, like, Kid or something. I just had friends that were in bands play, you know, Kip Malone, Nick Zinner. Like, I just bring them in. And then I would play when nobody wanted to hear. But after, over time, I did more, and then, like I said, people just started asking me, oh, you DJ? I found out you DJ now. Come to my bar. So I started going to these bars, and I had no idea what I was doing. And I didn't consider it a respectable kind of thing. But once I started getting asked to do dance parties, that's when, like, you know, I really started feeling inadequate because the kind of music I was playing at these bars, you know, like nobody wanted to dance to. And,
well, it's just music to drink to, basically, yeah. right?
Yeah, so I mean, I tried, but then there was so much more money. Another thing, I was putting on these big happenings at Glasslands with Vashti, you know, from Golden Triangle and Kills and all that. And she had an art gallery then called Live with Animals. And, you know, everybody dress up, we'd have themes, we'd do all that. And, I don't know, that was like, you know, we kept having these guest DJs, but a lot of my DJing became mopping up, like.
What do you mean, like closing the night?
I watched people ruin the party with their DJing, so I would come in and like try to figure out a way to keep people engaged or whatever.
Well, yeah, that is the kind of goal.
Yeah, and then also I had got a bunch of soul records, so I had done a soul clap at Enid's, but it didn't work out because I wasn't very good at it. But I thought,
so
this,
what year is this?
It's like 2007. And I really thought that there would be, honestly, everyone was listening to like DFA stuff. And,
right.
And everyone was listening to like, that's when everyone liked reggaeton. And you know, and that's when clubs started getting big subwoofers and all that. And I wasn't opposed to it as much as like, I just didn't, you know. Every now and then I bring out my old hip-hop 12-inch split, like Catch the Beat or something, but
nice. All right.
Honestly, I just didn't really like, I don't know, I wanted to figure out a way to play dance music that had drums and guitars and, and was more organic, and it seemed to me that the soul records and the, it's interesting to point out in that period we were talking about where music was more democratic in the marketplace, it was also more interracial in the in its listenership. Like if you, I don't know how, but a few weeks ago I ended up looking at the like 1960 like R&B charts. The big summer hit was Kathy's Clown by the Everly Brothers with black people all over America. You know, and the same thing, white kids were listening to black music and they had all these, you know, it was right in the middle of the segregation battles and these kids really wanted to be together on both ends, you know, like they didn't want to be separate. And then something happened in the later 60s, like particularly 68, you know, where, you know, there's all this separation, whether it be you want to consider that white people got into hard rock and black people start getting into funk or whatever.
Right. Yeah, there's like kind of a weird divide with rock and funk. But I think, you know, there's also a cross-section of people that love both. I mean, obviously. You know?
Yeah, but like if you read an interview like with James Brown's band, they always talk about how there were so many white people in the mid-60s. Right. And by 1970, it was almost all black people. It was just a handful of white people. And then you go see pictures of these white rock shows, you know. You don't see a bunch of black people out there wanting to hear, like, Fog Hat or whatever, you know. And the thing is that that separation, ironically, is right when the separation in sound came. All the records that in the earlier 60s, you know, they were all recorded in a room. You know, right. There was every now and then overdubs and stuff, and like
famous. Oh, separation of sound, meaning like.
But most of the records I play are people that are literally playing at the same time with all the bleed. And the other funny thing is, if you look at a bar band from, I don't know, 1965 or 1962, whether they be white or black, like you realize from like the songs the Kingsmen play or whatever on their records, they're playing the same songs that the black bands were playing. You know, in 1966.
It's a different take.
Everybody's still playing Midnight Hour on both sides.
Right.
You know, it's people had such shared experience with the music also. And it's just, I just think once you got this other period where you have the funk and the sort of pre-disco kind of things and all the things that became clubby music, and I understand why they did, and I don't disrespect them, but it all has to do with this compartmentalization of the beat. And honestly, for disco to have worked, you needed these DJs to have, like, those carpeted drum room kind of drums where you could slice the beat really tight. You know, when hip hop started, they were all looking for those breaks where you could get it really tight in there.
And like,
all this music that started coming later in Clubland was all about separation. And it was all about elongating things. And it was all about, you know, in a sense, like the taking the song structure away and making it more where you can dance longer, which I understand.
Right.
But my thing, more and more coming from my generation and underground music, I want it to be shorter. I don't want a song to go on more than 2.5 minutes.
Right.
And I don't...
The disco and funk records at the time are going like 6.5, 7 minutes long or 5 minutes.
And I love the excitement of like a real live sounding drum sound. And I love it when they get excited and speed up. I love when there's a mistake.
Sure.
I love all that. So for me, I was drawn... Once I started getting these 40... And again, I didn't have any 45s then. I didn't know anything about this music. I had like James Brown and Otis Redding albums.
So it sort of starts with that, with James Brown and Otis Redding, and then you get...
I had all the canonical people's LPs. I had a lot of compilations.
Sure.
But, you know, like when you put down like... I don't know. I found some records across the street when Good Bad Art Collector closed, and I gave the girl next door, I gave her all the 78s, which were really nice. Like, there were a lot of Sun 78s.
Wow.
I took the 45s, which were mostly crappy, but some of them were cool, and I started playing at my DJ gigs. And then when I was playing, a friend of mine worked at a junk shop, and he was like, hey, man, we just got in a bunch of these. You should come over tomorrow. So I went to the junk shop and got hundreds and hundreds of amazing soul 45s for a few dollars.
Right, nice.
And I just got so into queuing them up and how the beat goes out. I love transporting them on the subway because I had to take that big milk crate on the subway.
Right.
But the 45s had this little bitty box,
of course,
you know? And
then
over time, I was like, these are so great. And I had been looking kind of for, since as someone who likes everything, I've been looking for like kind of a limitation. I was like, you know, the Iron Chef, they're like, scallions and pork belly, go. And you show your creativity through what you have.
Right.
I think the big problem with bands or DJs and all that, now you can do anything. Everything is nondescript. It's just like, bleh.
You're right, yeah.
And so I think, and I already realized that then, and I was like, I want to have like a direction. And so I got into all kinds of 45s because, you know, this, most of the good songs you couldn't that I wanted, I couldn't even play.
Right, right. What, meaning that like you didn't own them or they're too
most tracks weren't available on 45 on LPs.
Right, right.
And then when I got into that heavy stuff, I couldn't afford the records I wanted because they're too hard to find and expensive.
Well, yeah, the 45 marketplace too. Now, too, more and more is getting scarcer, right? Like,
yeah, but it became a great thing because what happened was they ended up, when I was kind of having these, I was already having all these people at the parties, and like anything, people go to parties because they're fun. They don't go to a party for a DJ.
So the party meaning like the Soul Clap parties, right?
Yeah, Soul Clap was one of the first parties. The big first one was the Animal Train happening was the first one that we had that was substantial. The Motor City Weekly Party was a weekly.
Yeah.
At a weekly at the beauty bar called Boogaloo Shampoo.
Yeah, I remember that.
You know, starting the beauty bar
that was on Broadway? No, the beauty bar on 14th Street.
I started on 14th, and when they started on Bushwick in 2009, I moved there. But, you know, like, I just kept doing these things. But people go to the party, honestly, in the rest of the world. Like, I told you right now, Peter, we're going to go to this party tonight. It's going to have amazing music. No one will be there. Particularly if you're, like, 23 or 25 or 28, whatever. You're like, or it's going to be a bunch of, like, guys looking at the records to see if it's the first edition. Or right. You don't want to go there.
Nah.
You know, if I'm like, hey, we're going to go to this party, the music's crappy, but it's going to be all these interesting people we know there. And, you know, if you go to a party, like, let's say we're going to a party at Michelle Cable's house.
Right.
You're not going to ask what the music's going to be like. You're just going to go to the party. I mean, she'll have good music on, but you know what I'm saying? Yeah. People go to a party because of who's there and all that. And I had a lot of friends. I liked throwing parties. I'd been studying the history of New York nightlife and parties. And
sure.
So the DJing kind of came out of that and after that in a way to make the music at the parties more likable for a certain group of people, but also to where it didn't piss off certain people. Like I noticed when you're playing at these parties, you know, I had a lot of people from different subcultures coming and you play one kind of song and it turns some people off. You play another kind of song, it turns other people off. But you play some like Clarence, Frogman, Henry, and everybody's happy, you know, or some James Brown. Nobody's going to get mad.
No, of course not.
And through that, you know, also just those things become who you are. And it became really, I didn't even have to think about it after a while. The sound of the parties became these weird old 45s I kept finding. And as I found them, they were so interesting to me since I didn't know them. So every week, I mean, part of why I also kind of sucked, but it was kind of great. I didn't know what these things were. I was playing, and for years, in every week, all I played was what was new to me. Because I would
like a new discovery.
I did so much digging, and then honestly, once I started making a living, I started making okay money. So I spent all the money on records. So every night was just me trying stuff out on people. And I was working by 2008. I was working like I had 5 residencies, and I worked. You know, I mean, for a few years, I was working over 300 gigs a year.
But not just in New York, but everywhere, right?
But you got to understand that some of the ones here, I did a lot of after hours, I did a lot of whatever, so some of the nights were more than one gig, but, you know, like, a lot of these gigs were 5 hours, 6 hours, so I was going through hundreds of records, you know, every day,
Would you dig for records every day, like during the daytime, or what was your routine for that?
Well, I slept real late, but yeah, I go find stuff everywhere. When I started traveling, I found stuff more. I got on eBay when I got money, started buying everything I could that, you know, I buy big lots of records, you know, and I dig through them. I just lived every day. I made a flyer because every day I had a gig,
right?
You know, it was just like, and the funny thing is that doing things every night is contrary to like common sense. You think, oh, nobody want to go because this guy plays every night.
Right.
But really what happens is you, by default, in a time when New York was actually so funny, everybody in 2008 is like, oh, Williamsburg's done. Lower East Side is done. Everything's done. It's already all over. But really what we were starting to see was the first migration of this sort of new artist class.
Uh-huh.
The people that had seen all these bands and stuff on the road. There's a minute when, in like the mid-2000s, where every single band playing out of town at a nightclub was from Brooklyn. No matter what genre of music, you know, whether it's Antibalas or Black Dice, like every night. So all these kids that had new bands wanted to come here. All these people in subculture wanted to come to Brooklyn. So during that period in Brooklyn and Lower East Side, I was doing something every day, and there was a gigantic hole. Like, and you know, like Todd P was like the guy doing all the good shows back then.
Sure. Yeah.
But he didn't really have, he'd have DJs at his thing. It was usually band guys playing. You know, and the thing is, they're playing R&B hits and like top 40 and you know,
right.
And the skater kids are all listening to the top 40 hip hop songs and the classic hip hop. So for me, like, I was playing the girls at Beacon's Closet and like guys from rock and roll bands, and I played
them like a rock and roll DJ.
Yeah, where the people I knew wanted, they liked this stuff, and those other people, it turns out, at the Todd P shows and these skater hip hop kids or whatever, were still willing to deal with what I had, and some of them even liked it. So I was able to, on a nightly basis, you know, just play to all these subgroups. And for every, you know, I don't know, 50 people that hated me and 100 people that were indifferent in a night, there are at least 10 new people that I hadn't seen that thought, oh, this is pretty cool. We don't hear this music every night. And those people would come back tomorrow night or next week or next month.
Right.
So I built it really day by day, like the most grassroots style following you could. Like, it was really person by person. I met most of the people that were into what I do during those years. Like, they came up and would talk to me. Like, I had no... Now I don't know who any of these people are at my nights.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, that's because it's already, I mean, now it's been going on for well over 10 years.
Too. Yeah.
So what, Shaking Around?
Shaking All Over, Under, Sideways, Down.
So that's the longest running residency of them all, right?
Yeah, that's the mixture of Shaking All Over by Johnny Kidd and the Pirates, and then Under, Sideways, Down by the Yardbirds in one word.
Nice. So that's at Home Sweet Home, or?
Yeah, and that's every Friday for since 2008. And Soul Clap is still my oldest running party. I just, in New York, I haven't been doing it as much because of, I've been having a little trouble figuring out how to do it. But I've been doing, for instance, I did like 4 Soul Claps last month. They just were in different cities.
Yeah, so how does it translate outside of New York?
Great, you know, and there I have to give Michelle Cable some credit. When I met Michelle Cable, the Soul Clap was like the big kind of North Brooklyn soul party. And in fact, soul people didn't even go to it. It was just something.
Yeah, it was like rock kids.
Yeah, or just people from there. Art kids, rock kids, like Beacon's Closet employees. Like,
right.
You know.
Because they wouldn't go. Yeah, but you wouldn't see. Those kids wouldn't go to APT to see like Keb Darge DJ. You know what I'm saying?
No, and
like,
they wouldn't know who he was.
They don't know who he is. So
didn't know who he was back then.
Right, and that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that.
I built it all on my own. Like, I didn't know who any of these people were.
Which, is, in a way, makes it a little more... It makes it genuine because it's not like... If you weren't informed by some of the older brass, like a Keb Darge, who's like, you know, this elder statesman of, like, soul 45s and stuff, like, then you figure out your own niche. And people... As long as you have people coming supporting, then there's you can't hate on them.
No, in a way, it was a very organic, community-oriented thing. The sad thing is that my ignorance isn't a good excuse always for. But I really, honestly, I think it was my Texas rugged individualism. I didn't really care what other people did.
Right.
I already put it in my mind that I don't like record collectors that much, and that's the opposite of love and music fandom.
Right.
Or musicianship. Like, being a musician or being a music fan, to me, is different than, like, collecting. And the other thing is...
Sure.
And now it's different, because I guess I must be a record collector, because I have...
Well, eventually you have to become
one. Yeah, probably, like, 20,000 of them, you know? Right. And it's horrible. I don't want all these things, and I'm always struggling with the way I look at it. And through what I do, I mean, obviously, you know, I know a lot of these people that do 45 parties and stuff now, and I like a lot of them, and... I was being closed-minded. I didn't think those people were cool. I thought they were ruining old music for people.
Well,
I thought they were taking the things that were exciting about this music I liked and making it unexciting. And so I just ignored it and did what I wanted to do. But by doing that thing at Glasslands, you know, those girls had no idea what they're doing. Nobody went to their club. They were calling me because my band played there, and we sold out the Glass House, which is easy. And we had a really good night at Glass Lands when they opened, and they had nothing. And they were like, "Could you do it?" And I was like, "We broke up. I don't have a band right now. I just play records." Like, will people pay money for you to play records, someone else's records? I'm like, I don't know. But we did it, and it was really successful. But by the time I met Michelle, I had been doing this party for years, and it was still $3 to get in. I gave half of the doorway to the winner, and the party was so big, even though that space only held 250, like, by the end of the night, some of these winners got around $700. Like, wow. It's crazy. Like.
So for people that have
$3 cover.
Yeah, that's amazing. I mean, so for people that aren't familiar with the Soul Clap Party, because, you know, the listeners of this podcast are kind of far-reaching, like, it's essentially like you play a succession of 45, like, soul funk 45s that people then have a dance competition to, right?
Well, this is what happened.
And that's the most deductive
way. Well, right now, what it is, it's a four-hour, usually, party with, it's just dancing to these old soul 45s, right. And then there's a contest in the middle for about 20 minutes.
Okay.
But in the old days, we had no idea what we were doing.
Yeah,
and we went and
pretty free form, right?
Yeah, I saw these guys at this party I was DJing at. Like, I was in a band with a guy who was always trying to dance people off, and it was sort of a joke. Like, instead of fighting, you know, right. Like, dance off. So he had a dance off with this guy from another band. The kind of thing where I'm in a loft, the sun's coming up, the old Brooklyn, you know.
Right.
It was that same building where the Roebling Tea Room is, which was
upstairs in the
bathroom. Yeah, it was still kind of rough back then, you know. And
the whole building was covered in graffiti and stuff.
Yeah, so we're up in one of these higher lofts. The sun's coming up. These guys, everyone was watching it. It was so stupid. And I already had planned on playing Soul 45s next week at Enid. So I was like,
right.
I'm just gonna have this dance contest. And so as we did it, it got more compartmentalized. But when we moved to Glasslands and we did it, it was like, we used to let everyone have their own song for 1 minute, but it started to be right away, we'd have over 100 people wanting to do it. So there was no dance party. It was all just everyone getting their 1 minute to come out and do their freestyle thing.
Dance on stage.
Yeah. So just in the front of the stage. Okay. And everyone made a big circle. But
right.
And people really got into it, and people came out of the woodwork. It was great, but right. It was a real annoying party. So over time, we just kept trying to make it more elegant. So we made a dance contest. We put numbers on people so we keep track of them.
Right.
We had judges. We had all this stuff. Made it.
Yeah, so you curate judges.
Yeah, we made it into this sort of procedure. And the judges were funny because they were a distinguished panel of judges, mostly people that everyone knew. And all the dancers were people everyone knew. So it was sort of like, it was like some dumb theater. Everyone put in a couple bucks. The winner got half of it. After I paid the door guy and the sound guy, then I got the other half. So when Michelle met me, she was asking me how much I make for this giant party that, like, you know, over 500 people are paying to go to. And I was like, I don't know. It was a very small sum.
Right.
And so she's like, you're going to charge $5 now and you're giving away a $100
right.
prize. And I did that, and people liked it just as much. And
sure.
The contest became less competitive and a nasty, because when people are trying to get their rent, they're real serious. You know what I mean? And because in New York, judging, it was really something everyone wanted to do. I don't know how to express it, but it was just a fun, like, everyone's always asking me if I need a judge.
Yeah, people come up
to me. I never had to try to get judges ever, you know?
That's hilarious.
When we did it, it really worked out, and it became a compartmentalized form that Michelle helped work out around the country where, you know, we get like-minded music scene people in every town. They'd be our judges. And so instead of it being a usual party where a DJ from New York comes in and plays to a town, it's their party. They have, you know, their DJs there. Now, I mean, they're judges. Now I have DJs from the town usually come in and do this thing called contest selector.
Oh, interesting.
I don't like DJing with other DJs. I know this sounds bad.
So you like start, like, you know, doing the classic start and finish the night. You hold down the whole night, right? So,
well, I realize that the success of Soul Clap and Shaking All Over, and I hate to say this, a lot of it is that I DJed all night. And I don't mean that I'm that great at DJing, but honestly,
you have the control, the vibe. People know what the vibe is going
to
be like.
Well, that's the thing, is when you read those DJ histories and all that, disco, you know, people went to certain clubs, they didn't go to the gallery, Because Nicky Ciano was there, and he'd be there five nights a week.
Right.
And that's how it goes. You know what I mean? Like, you wouldn't... You go to a place because that's who the DJ is.
Right. The Loft is a great example of that.
But 45 DJs were always this thing where there's like 20 guys. Oh, not that, but usually there's at least three or four guys. And I understand because the records are 2 minutes, and it's really hard to play them for dancing. And but it's all these big crews.
Some DJs get burnt out after 90 minutes or 2 hours. You know, like.
But for me, like, I got out of economic necessity, like... No one really wanted to be a guest at the Shaken All Over party anyway when I started, and so I just did it alone and built this thing. And I was able to increase the energy, looking as a party promoter and not a DJ,
uh-huh.
I was able to increase energy when I needed to. I was able to slow it down when I needed to. I was able to shift the vibe when I needed to. So those kind of things, when Soul Clap came, you know, it was just me all night. I had an MC and I was a DJ, and that's how it went.
Right.
And I think that the success of it was that I could work with... I'm a very keen observer of the people that are there, and I have a relationship. Like, that thing about
they're
DJ
your crowd. You
being
know.
The mediator between music and people. That
right.
As the crowd changes throughout the night, I pay attention to them.
Sure.
Other DJs, you know, they come in and they want to play the new record they got and all that, and that's great.
Right, right.
But I really feel that in both situations, I tried to have guests at those parties, and it never right. went... as well when I have guests is when I do it alone. We make more money. And the other thing that's weird is that though the dance contest became kind of a joke. Like, I just started playing only James Brown during the dance contest. And people are all like, he only plays James Brown. So quit doing it. James Brown has so many records that you never have to really repeat them.
Sure.
And
I mean, there are many, countless of them are very danceable. Especially for people that just want to, like, get loose, you know, that aren't too judgmental.
So I created a contest selector.
Okay.
And that way, I can keep the vibe up all night. And those during dance contests, people dance to anything.
Okay.
And
slow records, too?
I'm sorry?
You ever throw slow records on? Like,
sometimes.
Yeah.
But at the contest selector, increasingly, I sometimes get a 45 guy, but sometimes I get a rock star, whoever, because there's a space between every song during the dance contest.
Oh, okay.
The group comes out. We call another group up. Whatever. So people don't have to juxtapose records.
Right.
And people will dance to anything because they're trying to win a dance contest.
Right, right.
So that's I've been weird. Using the contest selector. And in a lot of ways, I do use really good local DJs to help promote their party. And I call them up and I'm like, oh, when's the next party? And they play. And then it's a good way for collector guys to show off their record and talk about it a little and all that.
Right, right.
But it's also
talk about on stage.
A great way to get, like, the cowboy from the village people up there. You know, Randy, who I have a lot, is my selector. David
really?
Johansson, or, you know, these cultural figures who are
right.
really fun people and have good music taste,
right.
just not DJs. So I worked that out in every town. So now it's judges and that. And now I try to get a little known, preferably newish, local band, preferably that just got together in the last year and are kind of excited to play.
Right, right.
To open, because people don't go see an opening DJ in that opening hour, like, you know,
I've been
11,
that DJ many
it's
times.
It's very hard, and I feel bad. People are always making my friends be the opening DJ, and I feel like it's a bad position to put them in. So have a band. People come whatever time the band says they're playing, people will come.
Right.
So I have a 10 o'clock band. I go on 11. So if I go out of town, like, you have your local band, you have your local judges, you have the guy from your local soul party, or one of your local musicians is the DJ. And then I'm doing my thing all night. So you do have something from out of town, and it's a New York party, but it's also your party.
Yeah.
It's a community event. And what we figured out, which is weird, is it was a way, like what I was saying with a party, when you have a party, like you said, I'm having a party at my house, someone might be like, who's going to be there? These judges already, there's five people you know are going to be there. You know, you kind of know the kind of people that are going to be there.
Sure. Well, you've created, it is like a happening. You know what the scene is like. Yeah.
Yeah. So we took, I think, the revolutionary thing about Michelle's out of town version of the Soul Claps, it became this way where the music culture of the town, it's their party. And those people know it's a place that their friends will be and they can go. And that part of parties, I think the cult of the DJ left that in the dust a little bit. Like, they made it all about, the DJ's going to be here.
Yeah, it's all about the DJ, yeah.
Yeah, so if you're into EDM music, you see an EDM DJ, you know that's who's going to be there, and you can take your drugs, and you can go there, that's great.
Right.
But for other people, like, particularly what I do, there's only in a given town probably like 50 people real into soul music or something. So sure. I wouldn't make a profit out of town if I just dealt with them. I have to get a broader community, and the people in that community need to know that it's not something for just snobs or for, you know, people that dress mod or whatever, but that it's, you know, it's the kind of thing that, you know, fun people they know will be at, and it will be presented in a way.
Right.
And when they get there, I try to make sure that, you know, I don't play hits or anything, but that all this stuff is something they can relate to and feel, you know?
Right. Have you seen, like, regional stuff pop up that are doing the same kind of similar vibe? Like,
so I got a Google alert a couple of days ago, one from Arcata that's ending, that was inspired by the Soul Clap.
Right.
That was going for years.
Yeah.
And, you know, a lot of these towns, I actually like the scene a lot more now. A lot of these towns didn't really have that many soul parties 10 years ago. It was kind of changing of the guard time. There were a lot of these kind of 90s and early 2000s sort of funk and rare groove kind of parties that were on their way out.
Right.
And that culture, particularly when hip hop quit sampling, it really changed the nature of those parties.
Yeah, that's
and
a good point.
The Northern Soul parties and mod things that came in with Britpop, those were getting old. And so there wasn't a lot really for people in the demographic I was dealing with for that kind of stuff. So, I mean, and we also went through rock clubs instead of traditional dance spaces or old timey places or whatever. So, and I mostly wanted it because that's what Glasson was, but I also got used to playing for these really big rock PAs and getting this big rock and roll sound out of the soul music. So we kind of went out in the wilderness. We kind of did what, I guess, Michelle kind of did what, you know, Black Flag did with hardcore. We went out and we threw these soul parties at a lot of places that never even had a DJ before.
Wow.
A lot of them were just places where bands play, much less like a soul
DJ
or something like that. In a lot of the cases, that those places now have a regular monthly soul party. And a lot of them, you know, like I said, a lot of these things, even the ones that I didn't influence or whatever, I do feel like the culture around the things that we've been relentlessly doing for years in these markets has made it acceptable, I think, for a younger kind of different group of person to get into soul records and into old 45s. And,
yeah, it's a totally different market. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'd love to know how you went on tour in Israel, right? With I know Michelle was
2009.
So what was that like? How many gigs did you do?
I think 8.
No way. Just in the country of Israel?
Yeah, most of all were in Tel Aviv and one was in Jerusalem.
Oh, interesting. So you did a bunch of stuff. Yeah, okay, cool. So what was tell me what that was like.
I don't know.
Was it okay?
Well, I'm Jewish culturally.
Okay.
So it was nice to go to the motherland. I saw some old relatives. And,
cool.
And, you know, it was really beautiful. And, you know, Jonathan from Monotonic took us around. He's really fun. But, yeah, it was all right. You know, the gigs were a little rough. It was funny. I came in there to do a Monotonic record release party, which was a Faith No More show in the end. They ended up canceling and making it. They got a right to play with Faith No More, so...
What, and they canceled? And
I came for their record release party, and the record release party moved to this Faith No More Dinosaur Jr. show at a big arena. And okay. I did a good enough job where the guy invited me the next night to DJ at... what's that, James Murphy?
DFA?
No, LCD Sound Systems and MGMT when they were big.
Yeah, so wait, you did...
Like
so
when you were just getting on the radio and all that?
Yeah, with the Electric Eel or whatever.
Yeah,
so you did, it was Faith No More and Dinosaur Jr., and then the following night it was LCD Sound System and MGMT.
Yeah. And then I did all these after parties and weird discos, and I did the Tel Aviv Soul Club.
Wow. So what were the arena shows like? Like typical, like, there was there a disconnect with the audience?
Oh, it didn't really matter. I mean, it worked out pretty well. I also have been to Turkey, and I was playing a lot of Turkish music, and they love that there.
Dope.
But, you
like
know,
traditional stuff or?
Yeah, well, more, you know.
Funky
the
shit.
The thing about the in Turkey, they have the Turkish site.
Yeah.
But then they have a lot of these 60s and 70s Turkish records that they consider traditional that still sound plenty weird to me.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, really unusual rhythms for us and unusual scales, but it's got electric distorted guitar and all that. And
right.
So I played a lot of that and mixed with soul music. But, yeah, that it was a really weird,
Did they have turntables, the right kind of turntables?
Yeah. No, they had the whole thing. And you know, yeah, everything worked out all right. It just wasn't great, you know. It wasn't, I did a lecture.
Really?
You know.
In like a gallery or a cafe or what?
Yeah, some bar. They asked me to do a lecture, and I was like, God. And I really didn't have anything planned, and I kind of BS'd my way around some subject, and I kind of came up with some closure at the end. And it worked out. Like, everyone clapped, and I thought, wow, I can't believe that worked.
You talk about DJing? Or?
No. I talked about soul music. There was some... It's crazy. I don't know how it worked out.
Well, that's cool.
I really felt like I had them lost for a long time. Right. And it's sort of like when... do you see the new Trainspotting?
I have not. No. Is there a connection there?
No, we shouldn't even keep talking about that because it's okay. Like... It's people on the... That's to you. Okay, yeah.
Well, we can save that for the very end.
Yeah. But it's nice to be in Israel. It's just the gigs weren't that great.
Yeah. I mean, it's just such not a lot of people go. I mean, I actually booked Dame Funk in Tel Aviv in 2009. I booked him one European tour. We did that. But, I mean, not a whole lot of people go there. So it's just.
Well,
it's
also now a lot of people won't go there because of it. Right. You know, a lot of people are boycotting. I can't decide. Back then it was different, but. I couldn't decide if I'd go again right now because one thing is that I keep thinking I'm not going to help the economy anywhere that much when I go there. and the thing is that I could, though, give people the voices of disenfranchised black Americans that didn't have human rights in the 60s, which I do think would have a lot of relevant things to the Palestinian flag. Or in Russia, you know, I think, yeah. You know, I keep thinking of it in terms of, like, I got asked to do something and I was like, well, I don't know. Maybe I should. Maybe that's, how else... Am I going to help or hurt their culture by doing it? Because I definitely am not going to be bringing... I do realize once you're a Madonna or somebody, you're bringing it...
Yes.
You're taking a huge part of their economy out when big live performers are playing.
Yeah, like when Radiohead cancels the show there. Yeah, it makes sense. It makes
but when
it a cultural impact.
A little club act doesn't go, you might be hurting the people by not giving them access to something that might actually transform
them. Very true, yeah. Did you sing? You sang on a Psychic TV record.
I did sing on a Psychic TV record. Well,
so what's the story with that? There's some points I want to cover.
Conversation. Well, okay. I was writing. I had a little fanzine, and Gibby Haynes of the Butthole Surfers. Yeah. He would said, "Hey man, Genesis Peores wants you to interview him." I'm like, "What? The father of industrial music wants me to interview him?" He's like, "Yeah man, he really likes your stuff. He wants to talk to you, man." I'm like, all right, cool. Oh, yeah. He's like, yeah, come with me. I'm going to record with him. You can talk to him. So I go to New Jersey with him, and you know, we're hanging out, and Gibby is doing some vocal track. And so I'm like, hey, Genesis, so I heard you want to interview me. And he's like, huh? And I'm like, I heard you want to interview me. He's like, I don't know what you're talking about. For what? And I was like, oh, it's a zine and everything. He's like, well, I can. I don't know what you're talking about, you know. And I was like, oh, that's weird. And I asked Gibby, but I was like, yeah, man, I didn't want to go down there all alone, you know.
And, oh, he hoodwinked you.
Yeah, so, but he liked my voice. He's like, will you go in? And he handed me a lyric sheet and had me sing because he thought I had an unusual voice.
Wow.
And I did, and he liked it, and they ended up calling me and asking me for my full name for the credits and everything. So.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so it ended up being pretty cool, but it was a really random thing.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I stumbled across that, and I was like, oh, man, I had no idea.
I know, it makes it look weirder and weirder all the time.
Nah, it's cool. I mean, Psychic TV, of course, is such a legendary group.
Oh, no, Genesis is an uncommon cultural force.
Yeah, definitely. Are you a fan of Art LeBeau?
Yes.
I feel like there's like a connection of what the music that you play. I mean, Art LeBeau also is a cultural icon.
He had a lot of variety.
Yeah, definitely. And I think a lot of people in Los Angeles, see, I don't know, like when you go to LA, when you DJ or do soul claps in LA, if it totally translates to the same people that Art LeBeau reaches, you know, but
there's my crowd there better than here. And I play at theaters sometimes there and stuff. Like, Soul Clap's pretty big. Like,
LA has such a different appreciation and history with, like, classic soul music.
Well, the thing that makes classics. LA is the Chicano crowd, man.
Yeah.
Honestly, the one thing that I really like about going to other countries in particular is this is one of the only countries in the world where people aren't into their heritage.
Right.
You know, and we have such a rich musical heritage. And it's crazy. America's always thrown with the past. The thing that's really cool is that, first of all, I'm very interested in Chicano soul music. I love Brown Eyed Soul. I love Chicano Garage. I love all those. I even had the Midnighters and Premieres play at the Soul Club in LA before.
Nice.
And so what I really like is that, you know, the kids there in their 20s, they're still very into the 60s music, you know. They know all the, they know the whole lineage. And they come out and they know that I respect it. And it's just, and they also understand that a lot of the black records I play that aren't Chicano records, you know, are the records that those guys listen to and covered and do whatever. They understand for sure all the connections, and I deliberately make connections too. Like I'll play like Stevie Wonder's La 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 La, which is the best really early song of a little kid, you know. The Blindells, this Chicano band covered it. So I know that if I play that in LA, yes, that it'll have meaning to these people that it won't have anywhere else in the world. And so Art LeBeau, I mean, definitely, and a lot, LA record culture is amazing.
Yeah.
But I do think definitely LA's Chicano culture is the thing that for me makes it my favorite place probably to play, you know?
Nice. Peerless Records too, isn't that a Mexican label?
That was one of the many ones that, you know.
Are you pretty adept on the South American and Mexican record labels for garage and psych?
No, I mean, soul. I obviously have a lot of Peerless Records, and I have a lot of Mexican records. But like last week for Cinco de Mayo, I played only Mexican records.
Nice.
But the thing
now
is,
now it's a range of genres, obviously, right?
There's rock and roll, you know how it is. Peruvian records are totally different.
Yeah.
Peerless had a lot of them that they sold in L.A., but it's a Mexican label. But the big ones in L.A., like Pharaoh and Rampart, owned by the same guy. And those are the ones that have most of the records that the kids I play to down there did. And the funny thing is, it's not just Chicano bands. I mean, Barry White, I played this record by him. His first record under his name is Tracy. And I play that one, you know, and that's on Rampart, you know. Or maybe it's Pharaoh. I think it's Rampart. Can't remember.
How does it go over?
Huh?
How does it go over?
Great. Everyone knows that record in LA. It's an expensive record. It's difficult to get, but they, I mean, like I said, people there know the history of it. And to be honest, I really enjoy people that get excited with that kind of cultural history of it more than people that collect records and are like, oh my God, I can't believe that you own a copy of blah, blah, blah. Or you're playing some song that they know from a compilation. That's fine. But I really like it when people are into the cultural meaning of the record.
Oh, for sure.
And I guess that my big hope in the second phase of my career or whatever this is that I can get more and more people of different age groups and, you know, cultural backgrounds to find the connections between what I'm doing. Because I'm laying these little bitty, I'm hiding these Easter eggs all around for everybody to pick up.
Right.
And once someone picks it up, I will expound on it live. Like I wait to see if anyone grabs something, and I never always improvise everything, and I wait. And honestly, most of the time now, more than ever, I have to do art for art's sake, because 10 years ago I could do a cover of the Oogum Boogum song or the Oogum Boogum song. Everybody knows it. Now, kids don't know it as much.
Yeah, the paradigm is shifting.
However, they're more likely to know some incredibly rare record. But that mid-grade kind of thing where you make references, where you speak to people, it's hard to speak to people. They all know Twist and Shout and Woolly Bully and a few of these songs.
Right.
But, you know, honestly, you know, you can't just reference, like, the top 50 songs of all time. It used to be that the vocabulary of your average person that would go out would be many times greater. And now that it's less, it's in a way made me a better DJ because I have to just play really good music since I can't deal with familiarity.
Right.
But I wish that I could get more references. But that's to say that what gets good is like I'll be in New Orleans Saturday, and even though New Orleans loves the hits, they love hearing their hits over and over again. There is something about I have a lot of these songs by different singers that people don't know there. Like I have a couple really rare like Professor Longhair and Huey Smith records and stuff. So you can kind of tell that it's them, but it's not a song that you hear.
Mm-hmm.
And I would love to draw that little connection where people will, and I still know it. Think about it. When you play an unknown James Brown song, an unknown Ike and Tina song or something, it's kind of great. It's almost like you played a hit because people, they hear Tina Turner's voice and they know, oh, that's Tina. There's not, like that thing I was saying about the elevators. Like,
yeah.
People know the 13th floor elevators right away. People know Tina Turner's voice right away.
Right.
And so I feel like you need these little touch tones to speak to people. You can't just play people random, unusual things all night. You can, but you need to do it in a way where they can connect on some level and relate to you.
Yeah, you have to build towards it. Yeah, yeah. You can't just hit them over the head over and over.
Well, and just speak to them. Like, if I speak to you in a foreign language all night, like, he has a beautiful voice, but once you hear, you know, I don't know, when you watch a Spanish TV station, like, right, blah, 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 Donald Trump, blah, 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 then you're like, okay, they're talking about Donald Trump.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it gives you a form of reference. You start listening to the other words in Spanish that you happen to know. You think, oh, yeah, they don't like Donald Trump.
Yeah. You start understanding the inflection a little bit more.
Yeah.
Shit. Yeah. I'd love to, for a sec, talk about Norton Records, too, because that's a big part of your world, too, I feel like, too, because of the records that they've re-released and exhumed and stuff, but also because you guys were friends.
Well, yeah, my compilations, too.
We're on Norton Records, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So how did you guys first connect? I mean, what's the story?
Well, we first connected is they connected with me because I'm a music fan. And in the 90s, I really got it. I read a review of one of my bands with a guy. One of the comparisons was I played like a mixture of Hazel Atkins and I don't remember what or the other thing. But I was like, who's Hazel Atkins?
Right. I have that record. They
and I worked at the record store, too. And they were like, you don't know Hazel Atkins? And I was like, no. So I it was like 1991 or something. I got into Hazel Atkins. I was like 19.
Wow.
And that's when I first had a Norton record. And they had these great Link Ray things coming out. And I don't know. I just kind of kept up with them over time. When I started DJing, Norton and their 45s before I... And their LP comps before I had 45s were... You know, I remember getting the Mighty Hannibal record, the Gina Washington record, the King Coleman record. At the early soul claps and stuff before I fully got into 45s, I tried to just buy the 45s of those records that were on there and stuff because I was like, whoa,
yeah.
I didn't know anything about stuff, and that's really good stuff. And so,
oh, yeah.
But, you know, Norton wasn't known for their soul. They only had a few soul records. They were mostly known for their, you know, early rock and roll, garage, and,
right,
and in a lot of ways, I mean, like, you know, I buy their little Pretty Things, 7 inches. And, you know, every one of those EPs, like, every song's amazing. And if you're a DJ, a lot of it's pretty danceable, you know. And it,
sure,
those Link Ray ones, you know, every one of them, the Sonics and Wheelers, every one is, like, the best record you ever heard. It's not like, we're all dealing with this medium kind of time now. We're like, oh, you know, people are digging up old stuff that's like, well, here's something that you've never heard. And
right,
all these kids now know all this unknown stuff that's unknown because it's kind of not that great, maybe. Okay, here and there.
Yeah.
But everything those guys put out, you could be guaranteed would be amazing. So, like, I just bought all their stuff. And, you know, once I met them, I started realizing that they're just really cool people. And,
yeah,
you know, they started DJing here and there. And so I started inviting them every now and then when I have those guest nights. So I'd be like, have them come out. And they were always some of the most fun guests that I ever had. And then, you know, years and years went by, and I just, you know, they invite me over for Billy. I always had his birthday party on New Year's Day, and
cool,
you know, I don't end up going over there. And when in 2008, I had this giant homemade crate that I bought. This guy made this huge crate that had three bars right, hold like over 400 records,
mm-hmm,
and it had my entire pretty much 45 playing out collection, like my regular rotation. I left it in the back of a cab.
Oh my God!
And Norton was so great because I went over there and they really helped me like get a lot of records and then, you know, a lot of them had to get reissues or whatever, but you know they're cheap and all that. I don't play any reissue ever anymore. I play only original records and stuff. But back then, like, I relied on that stuff and like they totally took care of me. And then they had a, you know, I don't know. We just always ended up hanging out and having similar interests. And then they had When I had my accident, they did benefits for me.
Well, yeah, Billy, when we did the one at Brooklyn Bowl, you know, Billy was, I reached out to him and was able to, I was very happy because you guys had such a close personal relationship too, and they were a part of that.
Yeah, know? No. So that there, and then they had their flood.
Yeah.
You know, I was over at their house cleaning records and doing benefits and doing, and that was the hugest, anyone here that didn't know what happened, the worst thing ever. They had this giant warehouse. Like, basically a lifetime of work in this warehouse. And the whole thing got flooded. And basically our job, the salt water was ruining all the records. So we had to clean all their friends, we all came there and like cleaned all the records.
This was during Sandy, right?
Yeah. So that was really bad. And then Billy got really sick after that. And there's been a lot of stuff. But, you know, when they asked me to do a compilation, it's so funny. Billy had this weird idea where, you know, these Mad Mike compilations. I don't know if you've ever seen it. Mad Mike's this Pittsburgh DJ who is their favorite DJ and probably mine. This guy changed the world. And you should one day read the liner notes on his first album. It'll change the way you look. This guy thinks like me or like any of us, like, but in the early 60s, like, wow, this guy in Pittsburgh, he'd have thousands of people at his parties, but he did cover-ups for anyone else. He played all odd tracks. He had unusual taste, the coolest, and he always had a really crude portrait of himself on the cover. And Billy was like, I want to do a compilation for you like that. And the odd thing is, I had already been, so weird that my odd friendships with like Sacred Bones and, you know, and Mike Snyfer and all that, you know, like they had asked me about doing comps, and Caleb and I were loosely working on a Soul Clap comp, but not really working on it at all. It wasn't really happening. And, so I told Billy, I was like, well, I know y'all don't do soul much, but if you want to do a soul one, we're kind of working on that. And then, so he's like, yeah, that'd be great. And so I give him this list and can't use any of it because I want my compilation to be democratic. Like, I want Little Richard on there. And
well, yeah, licensing some of that stuff might be a little tricky.
Yeah, I didn't know how hard all that was. I was really ignorant. I never put out a compilation. I had a burger tape or whatever. I didn't know anything.
So well, that's like a mixtape, though.
Right? Yeah. So I didn't know anything. So I, you know, we kept going back and forth. It turned out I was in Chicago, and I really wanted to master the record myself because that was important, that it sound like 45s. I wanted some kid who DJs to buy the record and put it on at his, because I remember playing those comps at my gigs and they're always quiet and it sound like these 45s.
Right.
Maybe where could they even cheat on the radio or do, you know, and where someone who went to the party could take it home and it sounds like the party.
Sure.
So we're doing it in Chicago and going back and forth. And I literally have the crate of records that I'm playing with in Chicago, and I'm still emailing him back and forth while we're doing one and two. Over like what stays and goes. So side two of volume two is stuff we kind of agreed upon in the last minute. Because it was just what I had. And in a way, it was so authentic, and that like a lot of these compilations, people wait their whole life and put their best, most, and me, I put what I had that weekend on there.
And that works.
Yeah. And he was very present in the first two, and then he got really sick. So the next two, I mean, he approved all the tracks and went through it, but I did the covers myself on that. I had Lenny K write the liner notes on one of them. The liner notes on the other one. I worked out the front and back. And then the last one, he was really, really sick. So we just sort of, I was kind of like holding off because I just didn't think, he was really eager to put out records because I was one of the only things that could come out. And he just, I was just worried. I didn't know, you know, because I didn't know if he'd be able to fully oversee it. But he was still sharp in his own, like, he'd have really lucid moments. And
so that was, like, one of the last things that he did, right? Like,
well, it might have been one of the last ones when he was alive. They just had a Dion record come out this week. Can you believe it?
No.
And they were working on it then. And he was, one of the things later in his life that he was thrilled about was that Dion agreed. This amazing recordings in the mid-60s, like 65, that kind of Dylan-influenced recordings that he never wanted out. And he decided that now's the time. And sadly, it had to come out after Billy died. But he was working on it when he died. And Miriam, you know, she did a great job. And she introduced me to Dion the other night at a little party. And
how was that?
It was great. And she's doing a great job. And but Billy, you know, I have to say before we move on, like, I miss him all the time. I think of him like Obi-Wan Kenobi behind me at the DJ booth. Like, I know what things about me he doesn't like. And I feel him sometimes going, no, Jonathan. And I feel him like going, I play this one song every Friday just to think of him. Betty Lou got a new tattoo by the Creeps, which is like a Fort Worth record.
Wow.
And because I always think he used to love it, and he used to sing it in the A-Bones. So I always think of him smiling and singing that song. He also, I gotta say, man, when Billy passed on, it became very apparent to me, not just like I was trying to write this thing for Vice, and I didn't even get it like complete. Like, They put out so much stuff.
Norton Records did.
Hundreds and hundreds of records. And the fact that it was so good. And then, and when he died, you just realized at the funeral how much he changed your life. I mean, he had Roy Loney, the Flaming Groots, his hero, singing Teenage Head, Back by Daddy Long Legs, in the thing. And they're just looking around you, and it's just like all the people you ever respected of all time are all there. And I don't know. He just really made a difference. And Miriam is continuing and doing a great job, and she's putting out, you know, she's putting out, she has Kicks books too.
Oh, nice. Which,
you know, they had a zine called Kicks, and now yeah. So she put out a Sun Ra books, she wrote that Bobby Fuller book that was amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
So she's keeping the thing really swinging, and I don't know, really.
Yeah. I have so much respect for that guy and for the label, just, you know, aesthetically, and they just have such a great sort of angle musically. You know?
No, I'm shocked that they gave me comps. They know, you know, Mad Mike was the only guy with DJ that had comp before. Like he,
wow. So you're in good company.
They had this guy from the 60s. Yeah, he's been dead forever. Like yeah. he like they anthologized a lot of his, you know, hits. And then for me to do it, I can't believe it. I'm like, because, you know, like I said, those people are
they're
the top. And you know, the thing is, really, when I look at the pile of stuff, really, man, they're giants.
Yeah.
They make all this other stuff that I keep buying that keeps coming out. And I hate to say it, but they make these people look small and trivial. Because seriously, yeah. Like we're all grasping for like the last few scraps of things that aren't out there and all that in the compilation world and reissues and it. Their stuff, even if it's unknown or known, is always just the top.
Yeah, people should go back and learn, if they don't know that catalog, like revisit it.
No, they're aiming for the pinnacle, not for like somewhere in the middle that, you know, well, here's something else we don't know.
Right, right.
Yeah.
Well, I wanted to see, I mean, there's, obviously we could talk for a lot longer. I mean, I don't want to hold you too much longer, because you have a gig tonight, right?
Yeah, bring in a cool soul guy in named Don Bryant.
Oh, what's his story?
He's a Memphis guy, and he started in the late 50s with Willie Mitchell and all that. And then by the later 60s, he had his own records and everything. And you hear him singing on Willie Mitchell's That Driving Beat and a lot of these records uncredited on. He has a record I play, Do the Mustang. He has some really great covers. He had one of the great voices in soul music, and also a writer. Like he wrote, Can't Stand the Rain by Aunt Peebles, Nickel and Nail by O.B. Wright. Like all these, you know, 99 Pounds by M. Peebles. It's like he wrote a lot of great stuff too. And his voice is still there, and he has a Fat Possum record coming out this week.
Oh, yeah. We were talking about it at the beginning of the conversation. Yeah,
and he's backed by the Bokies, who are the craziest, the cream of the crop of Memphis studio musicians that you hear on all those cool old records.
So tonight's gig is you're just playing Memphis records, right? Records. That
yeah, I'm not. I don't even know. I'm not playing many records. I got a bunch of DJs together. I mostly did it.
Oh, okay.
For I don't care about the. One of the DJ jobs is I'm still a promoter as much as I'm a DJ. I hate that word because it's like no one wants to be a promoter, but. You know, I helped put together the flyer, and I put my friend's putting on the thing, and I decided to co-host it with him, put my name on it, and make it where more people find out about it. And I got some extra DJs.
Cool.
I mean, it's nice to have us there, but we're only there to tell people about it and create some ambiance. But I will be playing only Memphis music, but it's mostly we're there for advocacy.
Cool.
And hoping that this guy, 75 years old, backed by this great band, doesn't have one of those embarrassing Tuesdays that New York is so known for, you know how it is. It's the kind of thing where he'll die, and then everyone will be like, "Oh, wish we went."
Yeah. So, and how are you doing otherwise? You good? I mean, you're touring still like pretty constantly, right? You're playing constantly, right?
Actually, I slowed down a lot after the accident. I do once a week out of town. Which sounds crazy,
but
basically I don't go on tour anymore except sometimes in Europe. And I do, so every Saturday I do a soul clap in a different city, and on Friday I do the Shaking All Over in New York.
Oh, nice.
And then before you were
doing lots of, you do one fly-in after another after another after another, right? Like you were really pounding it on the road.
Yeah, like that week I got run over, I was in New York, and then the next night Miami, and the next night San Francisco, and I went to LA, and then Portland.
Wow.
And yeah. the next night I was supposed to go back to New York and then to Montreal next night. So at this point, like I have a lot easier schedule. And on the summer Sundays, I play on a rooftop in Bushwick.
Oh, cool.
My friends play Our Wicked Lady and
play
Soul on a roof.
You know? That's what's up. Yeah, classic New York summer, Brooklyn summer.
Yeah, break out the boogaloos.
Yeah.
The reggae versions of soul music. And, you know, it's a nice feeling.
Yeah, that's cool. Coming into this, I was, I don't know if it was necessary or not, but I mean, and I know you've talked about this before, we don't have to talk about that accident, but I do feel like there is something where we have a weird connection to it that I feel like I'd like to talk about for a second. Well, we both had, very traumatic hospital experiences, near-death experiences, that we share in common. But also the day of your accident, inexplicably, I was the first person that was called by the EMT, you know.
Really?
And and I don't know if you knew that or not.
No,
but
I
was sitting next to Michelle Cable at the Panache office on Graham Avenue, and which has since closed and moved, but and I got a call on my cell phone from an unlisted 503 number, which I think that's the area code in Portland, Oregon. Pretty sure.
Yeah, 503. Yeah.
Yeah, I lived there for 2 years.
Oh, wait, is that New Orleans or 504? 503. 503.
Well, it was from Portland. I got a call from Portland, and I picked it up, and they were like, "Hi, are you Peter Agoston?" I thought it was a cold call from a promoter. That was happening.
Why would
they
call you?
Well, this is what I'm trying to figure out by talking to you right now about it. And they said, "Do you know Jonathan Toubin?" And I said, "Yeah." Is he supposed to be in Portland, Oregon tonight? And I thought for sure this was some kind of promoter or something. I'm like, "Well, I mean, let me look up on the website because I guess he's on tour right now. I didn't book the shows." You know, that was the language I was using when I was talking to them.
Right.
So I was like looking on our calendar. And I'm like, he's supposed to play there tonight. Still thinking it was like someone trying to get on the guest list or some work related thing.
Right, right.
And like, well, he's been in a big accident and I'm trying to figure out a way to get in touch with his family. And at that moment I was like, you know, my heart sunk. We were working in a full office of people. And I looked over to Michelle and I said, he's there. He's supposed to be there. He's definitely scheduled to perform there. And then I said, "Michelle, listen, let me go talk to you out in the backyard real quick," because she had the backyard in that place. I didn't want to talk with a bunch of the interns and assistants around because it seemed very serious.
Right.
And then at that point, they described to both of us, I believe on the phone, that sort of what had happened. They couldn't really say. It was like an EMT guy or someone that was there on the scene or come to the scene. And then at that point, I said, "Michelle, listen, like, you know, you should try to find his parents, talk to his parents, you know, or get in touch with someone, because we're just homies. I wasn't your booking agent, nor did I like know where you were coming from or where you're supposed to go or and I still don't really know why they call me. Obviously, you know, I have your number. We have each other's numbers, but it's not like we had been like texting or talking like the day before.
My phone wouldn't have been.
I guess the phone wasn't accessible. They might have looked on our website basically and saw, okay, here's a guy. Here's a guy's number, because we had our cell phones on the contact.
They looked at Panache
exactly
and saw your name.
Yeah. And then that's when we just got into, like, you know, try to figure out mode, you know. And from that moment, Michelle went one way and I went the other. And then we started figuring out what the fuck was going on, you know, in that day, which was in the summer. It was a summer, or July or September.
I think it was December.
December
in 2011.
It was winter time. Okay.
Yeah.
And then not that long after. I mean, it might have been less than 24 hours, because it sounded, once we really heard what was it sounded so dire at in that moment, just because your imagination starts to like whirl around in your mind, that then I reached out to Brooklyn Bowl and started figuring out a way to, like, you know, we should try to figure out something right now because this dude doesn't have insurance and he's out there. I don't know. That's now I'm kind of reliving it all. I haven't thought about it in a minute, and I don't mean to drudge that all up, you know. But it's something weird where they called me and I picked it up. And I thought it was a cold call from a promoter or something, and we had this conversation, and then me and Michelle talked and we looked at each other, and we both had this like moment, you know. Mm-hmm. And I'm just glad that we can do this and that we can chat about records and random shit, and that we're both still here, and that we were able to bring people together, because that Brooklyn Bowl show was, you know, I poured myself into that.
That was so nice of you, man.
Oh, it's no big deal. I mean, really, gotta think, like, the Yeah Yeah Yeahs and the Strokes, you know, the Strokes played a big part in that too, even though they didn't perform. I don't know if you knew that or not, but and then of course John Spencer and Gibby and that guy that was in Kids.
I saw everything afterwards, but I wasn't when that happened. I wasn't conscious.
Of course not. No, I know. I mean, it was. I mean, the benefit itself was less than a week later, you know. Right. So. But it was a magical time. I was there from start to finish, and I got on stage and made a fucking speech just like I'm doing right now, you know, and about bringing people together, and it was an amazing turnout, and so many cool artists, you know, TV on the Radio and Ryan Sawyer and a bunch of Habibi, you know, and like and Billy, you know, DJ'd, he got his ass out, you know, so. And the people from Adam from Brooklyn Bowl and so on and so forth. So and Karen from Panache. So yeah, it was just a good thing, and I'm glad that you're well. And that was like such a, you know, unreal, unbelievable experience for everybody around you. Obviously, right? I mean,
yeah. I mean, I'm glad I wasn't aware.
Did you just wake up a week later and you're like, what happened?
No, it was like a month later. I didn't know anything. It took me a long time to figure it out. I still don't think I've dealt with it really, you know. I think my big job was to get past it as quick as I could.
Sure.
And I think I'll deal with it like in 5 years or something.
Yeah, you deal with it when you feel like it. Listen, when my kidneys failed and I was in the hospital for 3 weeks, man, like, I don't like thinking about what led up to that, because I was on tour with a band. I was in Brazil with a rock and roll band that I booked.
Oh, really? That's when it
happened.
Oh, man.
And I don't like thinking about that period of time because it bums me out, because it's a huge bummer.
Well, that's the funniest thing is that you know, that's one thing I try to, I mean, it's been years now, but for a while I really had to explain to everybody, like, look, this is not what I wanted. Particularly like within a year after it happened.
Yeah.
Well, everyone wants to talk. I did not. I seriously, I hired a guy to help tell everybody that I didn't want to talk about.
I mean, I understand. That's a trauma, you know.
It just gets to be where, yeah. Well, you know what I mean. You never want to remember the worst stuff, like, all the time. Over time, you get older. Even now, like, you know, I keep trying to get to where you can laugh at it or whatever. Oh, yeah, that was uncommon.
Yeah, I'd say so.
Unique.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because, you know, I mean, there's no way to... That's why the good Lord gives us humor. You know, all this bad stuff happens to everybody all the time, and you have to make sense of it, and you have to figure out a way to not dwell on it and move into... you know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
I keep thinking, like I look at pets or whatever. You know, animals... You know what I mean?
They keep it moving pretty good.
I think the problem with humans is that we're animals, but we tend to dwell on the worst things that happen to us.
Oh, yeah.
You know?
All the time.
And even if we don't, like me, I mean, you know it's in there, and then that's bad, too. Like,
yeah, well, you figure it out the way that works for you. I mean, that's all we can do, you know? But, I mean, the fact that you're, you know, embraced your talents and brought the DJing into this whole world that you kind of created, which is, it's dope, man. It's cool.
And, I keep trying.
Yeah. Well, that's all it came
to. No, I think I got a lot better after all that, too, because, I mean, honestly, I had to relearn it again. And every time you start over, you know, you get more of a sense of where you're at. And yeah. It gave me a break, too, which yes. I didn't... Before all that, I didn't really...
I wasn't really aware
of what I was doing, you know? I was just reacting, and
right.
all that time off made me think, well, what do I...
Yeah.
It's so weird when you haven't DJed for many months, and you don't right. know what you're supposed to do, and they're like, all right, now play. And you're like, oh, right. what do I do?
yeah.
I have some records.
Yeah, I mean, being in the hospital and going through trauma is a break like no other, you know, yeah. especially when you get to the other side and you can come home. And
yeah, it's, you don't have any choice but to reevaluate yourself and
yeah.
how you do things.
Yeah, and you got
like, every part of your life.
Absolutely, yeah. And you have great people around you, too. You have a lot of people that love you, too.
Right, I lucked out with that.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate you coming here and taking the time.
Peter?
It was fun.
And by the way, you look great.
Thanks, man.
You don't look like some guy that was sick either.
Yeah, I think we're doing pretty good. Yeah. I've had a couple. This July will be my 2-year anniversary of my transplant. So, and then it'll be 2014 is when my kidneys failed. So, you know, you just, time keeps going.
No, man, no one can see you. You're tan. You're healthy. You look amazing.
Thanks, man. So do you.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Thank you. Wow, that was great. I want to thank my guest, Jonathan Toubin, JT, for taking the time to come over and chat with me. What a guy. And it was a great, great conversation. I want to thank you guys for listening to another episode of The House List. Please subscribe on iTunes or SoundCloud. Feel free to repost it. I'm at Twitter at HouseListPod. So retweet it if you see it. And if you have a website or a blog, or you just want to pass it along to a group of friends, word of mouth style, I appreciate that. Definitely do it. There's a lot of great episodes before this too. Feel free to go peruse and check those out as well. Again, this episode was sponsored by House of Marley. The House List and House of Marley have teamed up to give away one of their incredible, sustainably made bamboo stir it up turntables. So if you're a DJ or record collector, if you got into it because of Jonathan Toubin, so you're all about soul and funk 45s, or if you are a lifer like me that has been buying and collecting records and DJing for the better part of the last 20 to 25 years or longer, then all you got to do is email me at thehouselistpodcast@gmail.com. That's thehouselistpodcast@gmail.com with the subject line, stir it up. And one lucky guy or gal is going to get picked out at random and be sent this amazing, brand new, fresh out the box, sustainably made stir it up turntable. You can see pics at the House of Marley Instagram, which is just House of Marley, or go to houseofmarley.com/turntable and check this out. It's dope. I'm telling you, man. I've seen it. And you can put your USB cable in it. You can digitize vinyl off of it. You can play 45s. You can play 33s. You know, you can run it through any House of Marley speaker. It's got a built-in headphone jack. It comes with an Audio-Technica cartridge that's replaceable, solid steel tone arm. I mean, it's the real deal, I'm telling you. So you have until June 1st, people, to write me and try to win this very special promo that I'm doing with the good people at House of Marley. So for all my listeners at the House List Podcast, hit me up. Try to get that turntable, and you'll get it sometime at the top of June. And next episode, I'll be in Budapest. So that's going to be great and amazing. All my family lives there. I'm going to go meet my dad, and we're going to hang out in Budapest. And hopefully I'll interview a couple really cool upcoming artists in that scene, because it's an amazing one, and I'm trying to help document it. So thanks again so much for listening, y'all, and I will catch you next time. See ya.